I'm not really
I didn't say that.
I'm not
We can get started. The Economic and Community Development Committee and the Finance and Business Services Committee public meeting tonight will be streamed live and recorded for publishing on the internet. So please note that an audio and visual recording is taken of this meeting. That means that your presence at and any or all contribution you make to the meeting may be collected, used, disclosed or published publicly by the council, including transferring outside of Australia. So with that warning in place, can I declare open the Economic and Community Development Committee meeting of Tuesday the 19th of April, and begin by acknowledging that we are meeting on the traditional lands of the Kaurna people of the Adelaide Plains, and that we pay our respect to elders past and present. We recognise and respect their cultural heritage, beliefs and relationship with the land. We acknowledge their continuing importance to the Kaurna people living today. Members, we've got a one of our councillors, Councillor Slama, on leave. I don't think we have any other apologies. No? Confirmation of the minutes. Could I have someone move confirmation of the minutes? Moved by Councillor Malani, seconded by the Lord Mayor. All those in favour? I think that's carried. Councillor Curran? Yeah, thank you, that's carried. We have no one registered for a public forum. We do have a presentation in a minute, but we've got no one registered for a public forum. I have no chair's verbal report, so we can move directly to the item for adoption on block. So members, I'll call them out, and if you can shout if you'd like any of these taken out. Obviously the presentation, item 7, we'll come to. Victoria Park, Pakapakanthi Toilets and Change Rooms. Councillor Clohan. Burnett Street Laneway Closure. Councillor Martin. Melbourne Street Precinct Parking Study. Councillor Wilkinson. Exploration of a rainbow crossing in the city. Councillor Martin. Wilcox Little Sturt and Chatham Suites Improvement Project. Lord Mayor. Items for committee to note, item 14, out of session information papers to note. I'll read them out. Renew Adelaide 6 month update. Notice of engagement and research activities, April 2016. Adelaide Town Hall 150th anniversary celebrations and the Beatles commemorative art installation. Adelaide City Council co-working spaces and creative enterprises in the city. Evaluation of the Fringe Connect project, Fringe Dollars.
Question.
Okay, so we're pulling out item 14 for a question of that number 5. That's it. So we have no items for adoption on block. How disappointing. So that means we can move straight to our item 7, which is a presentation on the World Heritage listing of Mount Lofty Ranges. And can I welcome Ms. Stephanie Johnson, who's the project manager of that bid. Stephanie's going to talk to us for 10 minutes. And then we have a short period for some questions. So over to you.
Thank you, Megan, and thank you for the opportunity to speak today. I'll put my timer on. Mayor Rosenberg went to the formal council meeting about a month ago just to formally introduce this project to Adelaide Council. And my role today is to just flesh it out a bit for you. I've also been talking to the Adelaide Parklands Authority, and I gave them a bit more of an emphasis on the case, the historical case that we're building. And today I'd like to sort of focus on, I guess, the economic opportunities. Now, I just press this guy. There are the PowerPoint loaded. And I'll keep going while you're doing that. Oh, there we go. So first of all, there are a bunch of, there's 6 councils involved, have been involved for several years now, along with the University of Adelaide, and the latest word is that Clare Valley also wants to join us. Randy Stringer, Professor Randy Stringer is an agricultural economist at Adelaide Uni. The whole thing was his idea. And we're getting to the point here now of determining boundaries of the region that we're looking at. And Randy said, let's shrink them and then everyone will want to get in. And that's exactly what's happening. We were trying to shrink the area and suddenly Claire wants to be in. So we'll be figuring that out probably over the next 6 months. The key thing is that this is, while we are basing our bid on a historic point of difference, the story of the history of South Australia, our motivation is economic. So what Randy did was identify that this is a very new thing in the world to have a World Heritage listed landscape, and we would be in the first 20 or so in the world. There are only a dozen at the moment who are World Heritage listed. And clearly from Adelaide Council's point of view, there would be links. Adelaide layout and parklands have many things and themes in common with our historical arguments, and it's clear to me that they would be linked in some way in the long term. The thing is, Adelaide already has probably jumped the biggest hurdle in terms of getting national heritage listing, and that's what we're trying to achieve this year. So we're gunning to submit to the federal government in early next year. And we need to get all the forces. That's only going to work, and it's a big bottleneck there now. So that's only going to work with very strong lobbying from everyone in South Australia, essentially industry, local government, and the state government. And we're sort of at that point where the state government is now starting to talk to us with interest. Just, you know, a lot of people just go, why the Mount Lofty Ranges? What's so special? You know, there's plenty of other places. You know, that are more beautiful, etc. The point is, you only need to meet one criteria with UNESCO. There's same with the National Heritage listing, but you know, obviously we're not going on this path without knowing that we could meet the world criteria. And really, it's all about our history and our association with the likes of John Stuart Mill, Jeremy Bentham, the formation of South Australia from the sort of reform period in European history. So we are confident, we get more and more confident that we can meet the criteria at the end of the day. As I said, those boundaries there on the right are the new environment and food protection areas. The purple, that's the green. The purple is the character preservation areas for the Barossa and McLaren Vale. The one on the left is just sort of council boundaries who are involved. But this is really the study scope. We're now getting to the pointy end, as I said, of determining what actual area we would like to list. So these larger areas are more likely to form a buffer zone and a management area, and we'll probably focus in on a smaller area for the actual listing. And that's where Uni of Adelaide is helping us. So we've got three faculties at Adelaide Uni helping us map all the different values, so that we can come to a justification of what area we will list. Why are we doing it? Basically for the brand. It's been shown and demonstrated over and over that the World Heritage brand has an enormous impact on both tourism is its biggest impact, but also on just world recognition of a region. So as Adelaide looks at its regional identity as a food wine producing area, UNESCO recognition is a bit like we always say, you know, three Michelin stars. It just puts you on the map instantly. And, you know, there's a reason, as Margaret Lehman always says, a very early supporter of the bid, it speaks volumes to her that places like Champagne and Burgundy, very well-known places, still think it's worthwhile pursuing this brand. And Champagne and Burgundy both got listed this year. Threats, that's a bit mixed up, but you know, we all know that there are threats to the agricultural landscapes. The EFPA is put in, or the urban boundary it is really, put in by Minister Rao just last week, defines an area that should not have housing subdivisions, but that's all it does. It doesn't actually help farmers make a buck. And Randy's point has always been that if farmers aren't making a buck, you won't have those beautiful landscapes there in another 100 years' time. So this is all about assisting farmers, tourism businesses and the rest to innovate, to experiment and to use the brand to add value to everything that they do. And I think this is where it ties in with some of the themes of Adelaide Council's forming strategic plan, you know, focusing on uniqueness, authenticity, sense of place, identity, culture, rather than just slowly and monotonously becoming like every other city in the world. And there's a, well, that's, I just went to the paper today because I've run into the guy, I know he came and presented here last week, Tom Haidu, the distinguished talent visa recipient. He's all over the place in McLaren Vale. And certainly, you know, Tom and I are on the same wavelength, and his article was supposed to, his speech to council was supposed to appear in the Indaily today, but I think it's coming tomorrow. Instead, I found Richard Brandy, you know, talking about the same themes, you know, underpinning innovation and so on. Attracting people here, there's a list of those kind of things, global profile, premium markets, innovation, investment, all those things. You know, there have been numerous studies by the likes of PricewaterhouseCoopers in the UK to show that if you wanted to, if you work it, that you can get all these benefits. So a key thing there is you have to have it as your motivation in the first place. If your motivation is just to protect, which is the case with most Australian World Heritage landscapes, we're actually just trying to protect the natural values. Not much has been done here in terms of using it as an economic tool, but certainly in Europe there are more and more examples of using the listing as a brand and as a tool. And there's the bit for you down the bottom. We have done a thorough economic scenario with Julian Morrison, who's recognised by the state government, and he showed pretty quickly that 50% of that benefit would go to Adelaide CBD. And we're talking, I mean, the numbers, they're only scenarios, but you know, a few hundred million in state product, a few thousand jobs. And these were all quite conservative. They certainly weren't the 30% figure that Champagne based their bid on. This is more like a, even the high was more like a 20% scenario, I think. And there's a bit of a glimpse, just a pictorial representation of impacts on employment and on jobs. The top blue bits, the rest of the state, the bottom other colours are the region itself. So and the rest of the state largely refers to metropolitan and central Adelaide, pretty much the CBD. The point is that there are no regrets anyway. These are, we want you all talking this up when you run into politicians, etc. The state government has reservations about, and at the back of a lot of people's minds, I think, was there was an era that would be in some of our living memory where there was the Franklin Dam protest in Tassie, where a federal government, that was the Hawke government, I think, stepped in to stop the state government building the dam, and there was an association there with the UNESCO listing. So I think that's at the back of a lot of state politicians' minds, that this may intervene on state government sovereignty. But the point, well, there are, I probably won't go into the detail there, but we've got our lawyers talking to the minister's lawyers to reassure him that there could be points, and you know, probably the mining industry is the one area where there could be a clash, but I think we'd all be happy for large-scale mining not to occur through the Mount Lofty Ranges. This is the reference that anyone can find on economic benefit. I think that's the key just sort of message. As I said, we're aiming, it's a long process, and the hardest bit is getting the national listing because of the bottlenecks, but we do have the interest of the Federal Minister for Environment, and but the strong message is if we don't get the state behind this by the end of the year, that they won't take it seriously, because if they're not being lobbied, they don't take it seriously. So we literally need strong support and understanding from the state. So right now we've got various people raising it informally with the ministers that they come across. We're aware that probably the two or three key ministers who need to be on board, environment, planning and agriculture, tourism, that's, you know, ministers Bignall, Hunter and Rao, are all starting to take this seriously. We've also got people briefing the Premier, who doesn't has heard of it but has said it's not yet a priority. So that's what we need to do between now and the end of the year, is get this to be a priority. And certainly, Minister Rao, we have had one meeting with him, and he could see the synergies with his urban boundary initiative, and saw our project as the icing on the cake, which is good because that's what it is. I think his boundaries are really seen by the people on the ground as just restrictive measures, and they're seeing our project as something that we're offering them that they can do something with. I mean, the wine industry gets it in 5 seconds flat. Some of the apple growers and so on are a bit slower. But yeah, I think that's where we need Adelaide to understand, and bit by bit businesses in Adelaide to understand how this will impact on them.
Thanks, Seth. I'll open for questions in a minute, but can I just start with one question myself? If you're aiming for a world, if a national heritage listing this year, and if everything went swimmingly thereafter, what's the timeline on it?
These things can be fast tracked or they can slow down. So we've always said stage one, which is getting national heritage listing, 3 to 5 years, depending on resources. Resources to date have been minimal. You know, we did assume at the beginning that we would get matching state government resourcing, which hasn't happened. So that's held us back. But we're still, you know, this January will be 4 years into that. So we're hopeful that we're roughly on track there, and then another 3 to 5 years to get World Heritage listing. But, you know, we have to be optimistic. It could take longer.
Okay. So members, anyone have any questions for Ms. Johnson?
The basis for the listing is based on it being representative of the colonisation process?
Partly, yes. That's at the heart, because we have to show association with global ideas. And the colonisation of South Australia, we're arguing, and can be argued, was a turning point in world colonisation history, as the world shifted from sort of random ad hoc colonisation, land grabs, come and get it, all those ways, that, and not to mention convict settlement, that here in South Australia was the whole Wakefield scheme and the planning of, and you know, there's a 3 or 4 themes which I did go through into much more detail with the Parklands Authority, but themes around colonisation, but also themes around contemporaneous British and German settlement as being a unique point, and I guess a number of minor themes, but also that are quite strong just in terms of our landscape and the way we manage it. So you have to both show the historical case, but also strong management. So just the fact that we have this urban boundary and EFPAs will be half of the argument. So half of it is historical, addressing the criteria, the other half is good management.
So given that, what is your opinion about the imperative for the other main representation of the colonisation being the Kernelite Park lands,
yeah,
to sit with this as part of this proposal? Or do you see that as because it's hot potato that might derail this endeavour?
Well, to be frank, I think I'm a passionate parklands advocate, and I see them both going hand in hand in one form or another. There are technical ways you do that through UNESCO. One is by serial listing, which is what happened with the convict sites in Australia. So you've got, you know, a site in Sydney, site in Tassie, site in WA, and I'm here, of course, listing for convict settlement. And that was called a serial listing. So it's like the sum of the parts. That could apply to a double effort, so for the parklands and city layout to go hand in hand. I don't see it as a hot potato, actually. It might be mentally, but when we go back to the impacts of the EBPC Act, they're already in place with the national listing. There's zero change from national listing to world listing. In fact, the values will shrink because there won't be as many world values that need looking after as national values. So to me, it's an easy argument to say, well, the parklands have survived national heritage listing. In fact, I use it for our own area. You know, I mean, unfortunately, it's had very little impact on decisions about the parklands. But, you know, I think I don't think it is scary politically in that sense. I think, and really for us, getting over that national hurdle, then you can say to everyone, look, it's business as usual, the sky hasn't fallen in. UNESCO listing is actually going to have less impact.
Yeah. Not scary for us, we're not planning to build any cold-story office buildings.
Members, any more questions? We're coming to the end of our time. No? I'm sure Steph would be happy to brief people individually or follow up with conversations if people wanted more information. But, yeah.
And we've got a bunch of fact sheets and things on our website, but feel free to email me and, I'll provide you with information. But, you know, main thing is for us to feel like we're working together with the city because, you know, we're both going to benefit. The hills are the city's playground, we all know that. Keeps people here longer.
Thank you. Thank you very much for making the presentation. Thank you for the work you're doing on behalf of the state.
Long haul.
Members, that brings us to item 8 on our agenda. Victoria Park, Kathy Toilets and Change Rooms, and Councillor Clariman, you've pulled that up.
I wanted to ask administration whether there'd been any discussions at this stage with people who live on East Terrace and the proposed location of those facilities.
Happy to move it.
Through the chair, at this stage this has not gone out to consultation, so the first recommendation is asking you to give us the okay to take these concepts out for consultation, so as yet no.
I've got a mover, so if you just want, if you can hold your thought for a moment, Councillor Clarahan, in case you want to ask some more questions. But I've got Councillor Abiad has moved this, seconded by the Deputy Lord Mayor. And back to you, Councillor Clarahan, if you've got any more questions.
Yes,
you're happy for the questions to go ahead.
I love that he's a Deputy Lord Mayor.
Oh, did I call you Deputy Lord? Oh, dear, oh, dear. Oh,
whoa! That's going to cause a scandal.
So you all reserve your right.
Just practicing.
Carry on.
Did the mover wish to speak? Or
no,
are they
reserving their right.
I just wondered whether, given concerns expressed previously in regard to both the size and the impact of sporting clubs and facilities adjacent to the residential areas, and we've got two examples of that in North Adelaide, whether we're just providing a red rag to a bull in terms of placing this so close to those homes on East Terrace. And there was another alternative which moved just a tiny bit further south, and I was wondering why that wasn't the preferred location, given that it's not that far away, but far away enough not to create any issues for us.
Yeah, I think we have recommended actually the furthest southern spot. If we go any further, we then move into the mound, and that would have significant contamination issues.
Oh, well, I must have misread the map there.
It means site C, so further east.
I thought you were recommending the one that was right on the corner.
Yeah, they're very similar.
I thought that was the site there, and what was wrong with site C? So we recommend. I thought you were recommending site A.
Yes, we are. So.
Which is very close to East Terrace, yes. And I wondered why not site C.
Move site C, I'd support it.
So there is an existing mound there that I think is containing contaminated soil, and so that's one of the big issues with that site. So you could potentially significantly increase the cost of the project. So that mound was actually created there as part of the Media Park construction works. So it's just some uncertainty as to how the costs will go.
I'm going to
foreshadow an amendment or
foreshadow. I'm going to. Sorry, we've got a few speakers coming up. So I've got Councillor Martin, then you, Councillor Moran, and then Councillor Magic. And Councillor Wilkinson. Councillor Martin.
Yeah, look, I think I would like to foreshadow an amendment.
You don't just move it.
Well.
I get a chance.
Okay. I would like to move the amendment then that the Economic and Communities Development Committee recommends that this matter be referred to APRA for consideration and then the following meeting of council. If I can explain.
One moment, we'll get a second of that.
I'm happy to second it if you include the words with no preferred site.
Or preference for C.
I don't want a novel APRA. I mean, I'm assuming that there will be healthy debate within APRA about it.
Yes, we just need a second.
I'm happy to second it, as I said.
Okay, so we've got it up.
If you remove site A as the preferred site and just give APRA the site.
Councillor Moran, I think Councillor Martin has responded to that by saying no, so I'm looking for a second.
To APRA.
Just remove the words preferred site.
So is there another way of saying that other than preferred site? I mean, without a site recommendation or something like that?
Yes, without site recommendation.
Without site recommendation, that's fine. And look, the reason.
One moment, Councillor Martin, I'm still trying to work out what exactly you're moving. I'm trying to get a second.
Yeah, sure.
So at the moment, we've just got referred.
What I'm saying is that the Economic and Community Development Committee recommends that this matter, without a recommendation for a site, be referred to APRA for consideration and then to the following meeting of council.
And the rest of it be deleted?
Correct.
Sorry, have we got a second for that, Councillor Moran?
Councillor Moran, a second of that.
Councillor Moran, that satisfied you?
Yeah.
Okay, great. Carry on now, Councillor Martin.
Yeah, look, let me just say I'm a little bit confused about all of this because it fits within a range of strategies. It's also in the draft management strategy for the parklands in a kind of a way. And it fits with the master plan as well. I should say I'm not against the proposal per se. It's all tickety-boo with me. But it is a matter that has been debated and been around for a long time. It came up in 2013 or 14, I think, in the notes. It was at that time to be an agreement between the RAN government and council for dollar funding for 200,000 each. And since that, it was deferred because of the let's bring racing back to Victoria Park. And the cost has now grown to nearly $750,000. So it's nearly doubled in cost. Well, I don't know whether it's because of site contamination or not, but the issue for me is that as far as I can tell from the paperwork, it hasn't been recently before APRA. And we are being asked to sign off on recommendations to go to public consultation, and then having created the expectations, we give it to APRA and we say, you really are important, and for the sake of the credibility of the organisation here, you approve it, which is of course the wrong way around. It should actually be, if APRA is the organisation that provides advice, policy direction to council, then it should go to APRA. And APRA should be saying to us, we endorse the administration's recommendation, or we endorse this or that. I'm firmly of the view that if we wish to preserve APRA, then we need to make sure that it's included in the process at the very beginning. Now, in this instance, APRA will have the opportunity to consider it in the context of not only the recommendation from the administration, but the draft parklands management strategy and any other matters that it has before us that have not been before council. And now I'm aware there's some urgency. That is to say that the government's offer of $200,000 expires at the end of June unless we do something, but I still think for the time involved we do enormous service to APRA by referring it to them and it coming back to us at the next possible council meeting. So that is the basis for the amendment, and I would ask people to support it.
Councillor Moran?
I think enough has been said.
I agree.
Administration, I'm just wondering whether you want to comment on the timing issue.
So we have the grant expires at the end of June, so that'll, I guess, make it tight. I'm not sure the timing right here now, as far as seeing APRA and then coming back to committee. Just the rationale behind why we wanted to come to you first before going to APLA was to see if there was an appetite from council to even fund this facility before even taking it before APLA and the community.
Can I just, Chair, respond by saying I wasn't proposing it comes back to committee. I'm proposing that it can come to council. So it would go to APLA and then come to the next available meeting.
Lord Mayor.
Thank you, Chair. Look, I'm supportive of this going to APLA. There is an APLA meeting on the 21st of April. I don't know, Chair, I would take advice as to whether this matter can be brought to APLA that quickly. I'm hoping it can. But in answer to your question, I speak personally that I think this is a very good project. There is certainly an appetite to fund it. And I think the design in terms of how that's been treated is very sensible. So I say well done to administration for the work done on that design. It's a very good piece of work. I think it's a question of location and cost. And I think APLA due process would take it to APLA. And I welcome any comments from fellow members about my sentiments about, you know, having an aspiration to do it. I think we should do it. I think there's clearly a need to do it because of the sporting facilities and the ovals there. I think that's well documented. So I think to APLA and then State's Chamber.
I've been advised that it can be tabled as a late paper for the APLA meeting on the 21st. Did you say that, Mayor?
Why can't it go tomorrow? I mean,
Thursday. Does anybody else wish to speak to this amendment, Councillor Clarahan and Councillor Wilkinson?
Well, I am glad I called this matter out. My concern was primarily about the location, given that you've got very large, elegant mansions on that east terrace. To locate something on their doorstep that does look quite rustic, or will over time, I just wondered about the impacts from the use of those facilities and also the appearance. I don't have any issue about providing the facility. I think it's really important, and I think that that argument was really well presented. We definitely do need something there. However, let's just give some consideration to one, the location, and two, what it looks like on the doorstep of those mansions.
Councillor Wilkinson.
I'll just make a comment, then just consider a further amendment for members to consider. The siting at the moment is in this location, and if papers go to APLA, it'll go to APLA. It's still showing this as a preferred location.
Councillor Wilkinson, can I just point out that the motion, the amended motion, says it will go without a recommendation for a site?
So these documents were changed.
It will be clearly going without a recommendation for a site. So that was part of the motion.
Okay.
The amendment.
The proposed location is exactly on axis with South Terrace. At the moment, when you're driving down South Terrace, you get a parkland vista. That will be replaced with a toilet block vista. Mm. Now that's poor design from my perspective. It might have been cheaper to put it there because there's not some mounding, but I don't think the cost of moving some contaminated soil should dictate how we locate buildings in the parklands. And I would consider moving that we express a preference for option C or for even further south. There's some trees, just bits to the south option C. I would see the nicer spot for it would be sort of tucked in close to those trees. So I'm not sure if there are members left to second the motion.
We've got an amendment before us, so we have to deal with that amendment first, Councillor Wilkinson. So we need to apparently vote on this amendment, and then if you want to move another amendment, apparently that's what we need to do. That's my advice. So the fact that you've spoken to this amendment won't preclude you from speaking back to the original motion unless you've already spoken to it. So, members, any further discussion on the amendment? Councillor, if no further comment, then back to you, Councillor Martin Summers.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. Look, I would urge Councillor Wilkinson to support this amendment rather than moving another. The intention is to give APLA the opportunity to voice an opinion without receiving a direction. Council. If APLA wishes to then direct our attention to one option or another, that is the opportunity for you and everybody else to say, yes, we accept that or we don't. So if you believe that APLA is the body that should make the call and provide the advice, then please support this.
So can I put those, all those in favour of the amendment? All those against? That's carried. That becomes a substantive motion. Does anybody wish to speak to the substantive motion? Councillor Abiat? No one else? Councillor Wilkinson?
I'll just flag that when it comes back to council, I mean, I've looked under the designer's eye and I think that site C is the better location. So.
Thank you, Councillor Wilkinson. That being the case, I think if everyone's had their say, can I put the substantive motion? All those in favour? All those against? That's carried. Thank you, members. That moves us to item 8, which has been called out by Councillor Martin, the Burnett Street laneway closure. Councillor Martin.
Yes, thank you, Chair. Look, I will move this if there's a second.
Sorry, we've got a mover. Would someone like to second this? Seconded by Councillor Malani.
Okay. This has been through a consultation process and discussion here before. But my question, and that is what I pulled it out for, because I have a question of the administration, is that it's acknowledged in the briefing paper that a business owner who leases 92 Curry Street, Mr. Bannister, and the owner of the property, the Pilates Group, both oppose the closure of the laneway on the basis that the tenant requires 24-hour access for motorcycles and other things. So the question is, on what basis would we discount the opinion of the tenant and the owner of the building to prefer the opinion of the proponent of the cafe, which is going to lead to the closure? I mean, how do we weight which, why did we reach that decision?
Sorry, the question to our administration directed to, Adrian, I beg your pardon.
Thank you. Through the chair, just to clarify that in the second round of consultation, there was no response from 92 Curry Street. So the proposal was amended after the last round of consultation. And so then after we went with the current proposal, there was no response back despite some endeavours by staff to get responses, and so therefore the negative response referred to there at 94 Curry Street was the only negative response in this round. And so in points 8 to 11, I think that spells out the reasoning there around dealing with the concerns of that stakeholder. In particular, the access to the rear of the building for a motorcycle should be manageable in terms of the space that can be left along the side of the laneway, and the fact that the delegation to the CEO includes that detail of finalising what the width will be that's left there for the area that's closed off. So they're the main issues. That's the main issue there, I think, is in terms of that 24-hour access for the motorcycle.
So what you're saying, if I read the paper, I understand all that. What you're saying is that we are not taking into account the complaint of Mr. Bannister and the Pilates Group on the basis that you think their issues can be managed.
Correct.
Okay.
Councillor Malani. Councillor Wilkinson.
I take the view that if the owners of the building and tenants of the building immediately abutting a laneway have expressed opposition to closing a laneway and privatising it, they've expressed their objection first time around, that there's not been success in getting a second thing. I think their position would probably still be the same, shouldn't then be used as reason to justify, therefore ignoring their original objection. So I don't, in the light of that information, I'm not prepared to support the proposed closure. If all parties on the laneway were all for it, that'd be one thing, and I would entertain that. But given we have got an objection from one of the key landowners and tenants that use that laneway, I think we should respect that. So I won't be supporting our call of division.
Can I just get clarity on this? Because I understood the answer to be slightly different to that. Am I correct where in saying that we got an objection the first time, we made some adjustments in order to accommodate that objection, and then we put it back out for consultation again and we didn't get an objection the second time? Or have I misunderstood your answer, Adrian?
Through the chair, just to refer to point two first. In the first round of consultation, there was opposition from 92 Curry Street. In the second round of consultation, I'd have to take that on notice just to clarify the relationship between those two complaints, Chair.
So yeah, the question is whether any changes were made to the proposed scheme based on that first objection. Did you answer that question the first time around?
Yes. Oh yes, I did. Yeah, that's correct. But some changes that were made were detailed there in 4.1 to 4.4. And that was the change of proposal that went out for the second consultation.
Yes. Okay. Thank you. Anyone else wish to speak to this or ask any questions while we've got Lord Mayor?
Chair, just a question through administration. It was just mentioned, I don't know if this has already been covered, excuse me, but it was mentioned that you did not receive a reply. Do we know why we did not receive a reply from one of the landholders?
I know that attempts were made to contact different landholders and no response.
Are they an absentee landowner, to your knowledge?
Can't help with that question, sorry.
I think it's a good project, and I must say I would take considerably more comfort if there was unanimous consent from adjoining landholders on this project prior to proceeding. So,
why
don't we defer
it? Councillor Bishop?
I was actually going to say the same thing. Could we defer it until we've actually made contact with the respondent, Mr. Bannister, and the Pilates group? And once we've got a reply from them, because you've obviously made the amendments, but they may not have seen it or had a chance to respond. So if we could get their response, they're happy to support it.
So can we get, that was also my thought, so can we just get some comment about that? There's no timing issues or concerns about that?
Through the chair, no, there's no timing issues that I'm aware of, so that'll be fine.
So can I get someone to move a deferral? So moved by Councillor Moran, seconded by... So you moved that, Councillor Vishal? Yeah, I think I didn't actually pick that up. Councillor Moran, seconded by Councillor Moran. So the matter be deferred to...
Until a reply from administration to get a reply from the respondent.
To allow administration to get a reply, to get a response. So, do we need to defer it to a particular meeting? It's okay. All right. So, Councillor Vershaw, you're content with that? Do you wish to speak to that further? Councillor Moran, do you wish to speak to that? A seconder? Councillor Clarahan.
Did I miss some diagrams in this report?
We don't know.
Are there any diagrams pertaining to this?
This one and the photo?
I obviously did. But in terms of its location, there's nothing there.
Yeah, that's right.
And I don't think that's probably the standard that we're used to in terms of sale or purchase of property. I think we need to actually have better diagrams than a wall or a picture of a door, a couple of doors. So if we could,
so perhaps that can be taken on notice.
could we please have a proper diagram of the location of this particular area?
This one? There is a diagram.
Was that it?
They speak to.
We had.
Okay, we've got the point. Thanks, councillor. Anybody else wish to speak to this amendment, to this deferral amendment? Can I put it? All those in favour? All those against? That's carried. That becomes a substantive. Can I put the substantive? All those in favour? All those against? The substantive is carried. That brings us to item 10. Councillor Wilkinson has pulled out the Melbourne Street Precinct Parking Study.
Thank you, Deputy Lord Mayor. I'd like to move an amendment to what's recommended and also amend recommendation 4 and remove the word not and to add after the word car park to significantly increase the number of car parks provided on the site with a residential development above.
And we need a second for that.
If I could speak to explain the rationale.
We need a second before you can speak, that's a direct. So apparently it's a direct negative.
Happy to move as printed.
So
yeah, one is not received, one is not received.
Okay, but in any event, we haven't got a seconder for that.
The seconder, is there no mechanism for me just to explain?
One moment, we'll get the actual original motion moved, and then we can talk about it. So, moved by Councillor Abiyat, we talked about the original motion and seconded by Councillor Moran.
No, I'm moving an amendment.
Sorry, moved. Councillor Abiyat has moved the original motion, yes, and I'm seeking a seconder for the original motion. The motion as printed by in our paper.
If you remove 4, well, that's a better
can we
motion.
Please, Councillor Moran, can we just please get a? We need a motion procedurally on the floor.
Yeah. Procedurally on the floor. Happy to move as printed.
Thank you. And then can somebody move? Thank you, Councillor Vershaw. So, Councillor Abiyat, do you wish to speak to this?
Was that Moran?
Councillor Vershaw. Right, Councillor Moran.
I'd like to move an amendment which deletes 4. I have some sympathy with what Sandy's saying, and it was a long-term plan that we put a car park with the residential there. So I don't want to say not proceed further. As the Lord Mayor pointed out to me, the motion reads perfectly well without directing us to not do something. So I think that would make more sense to just have 1, 2, and 3.
So Councillor Moran's moved an amendment and it's been seconded by Councillor Mullaney.
Happy with that.
Councillor Moran.
Oh, I've said it. Councillor
Mullaney.
Agree.
Oh, sorry, yeah, 5 and 6. Yes, sorry, I'm just leaving out 4. I'm still in retaining 5 and 6.
Thank you. Councillor Vershaw. Through the amendment.
Through the chair, I'm just wondering whether that affects number 6. Because we're endorsing another action. I would ask administration.
So administration comment on whether number 6 is.
Through the chair, I can potentially answer that. Currently, there's a motion before the administration to look at the redevelopment of the site. Council presented, I think, in 2015. Maybe late 2014, 7 options for the redevelopment of the site, which looked at parking as the biggest gap to understand. That's what led to this parking study to play out, which the evidence of that parking study is before you tonight. So there is a scenario which suggests that there's going to be 2 motions of conflicting nature before the administration. One is to look at maintaining parking on the current site, or perhaps tweaking the way the parking's operating, and the other one is to look at a redevelopment of the site.
If I can, I don't quite know how we administratively proceed, but if I can just give you what I think is the common view amongst the councillors, and that is that we are keen that parking be preserved there, but that we look at
the highest and best use for that site, which would include parking at maybe at ground and above, or maybe even below, but look at what the development opportunities are above it. That's, I think, where Councillor Wilkinson is, what Councillor Wilkinson is trying to achieve, and I think a number of other people are also interested in that. No,
no, I disagree with that.
I beg your pardon. Okay, no, let me just go back. I'd like to get some administrative advice about the issue that Mr. Phillip has raised, which is that this motion might then conflict with another motion that we've already got on the books. Can I get some help on that?
I'm
quite clear on this because I was here when the other motion took. The motion recommended by the administration conflicts with what we want because it says not to proceed.
Yeah, get rid of six.
And I'm saying we're silent on that, yeah. And that leaves the original plan and direction of council still in the game.
Get rid of six. And I'm
get rid of six as well. Get rid of six. All right, I'll move six as well.
And I'm not going to do that.
Okay, members, the suggestion is that we vary the amended motion by also deleting six. The mover has suggested that, the second is happy with it. Can I get a show of hands that other people are happy with that change? Anybody not happy with that change? That's changes.
Do we have to have unanimous endorsement to vary?
Okay, so the variation is allowed. So where does that take us? We're down now. Councillor Moran has spoken. Councillor Moran. Sorry, Councillor Abiyad, no, where am I up to? I've lost my plot. Lost the plot. Councillor Vershaw reserved her right. Who's next? Right, Councillor Martin, Councillor Wilkinson, the Lord Mayor.
Thank you, Chair. Look, this is another of those Yarwood era recommendations for which half of us have absolutely no background. It goes to 2012. When it was decided that this might be an option, then it went finally in September 2014, in the dying days of that council, out for an investigation. And it rolled the two things together, that is the Dunn Street car park and the possibility of a development, with the adequacy of car parking in Lower North Adelaide. And the mistake that I see coming tonight from my perspective is that everyone is getting into the bandwagon about developing the Dunn Street car park and ignoring the other part of the recommendation, which is more substantial and, in my view, much more controversial. Now, that document writes off development as it was proposed by the Yarwood era, slightly, slight arguments, at 17 and 22 to 26. And that's fine. I mean, I'm happy for that to come back in another form to council to consider or to instruct the administration on how to proceed with that. But frankly, we are in deep trouble in North Adelaide with ratepayers if you approve this, because we are adopting a one-year-old report about parking. This was conducted a year ago, almost to this month, in North Adelaide by consultants. And things have changed. In fact, residents and businesses believe that things have got worse. And yet we have, even in the time since that study was taken, made those special arrangements for nurses on McKinnon Parade so that they are taken off the streets. And yet the ratepayers, the residents and the businesses are all saying the parking problem is worse. Now, this report then goes on to recommend that the best way of fixing this is addressing the primary cause of the parking issues that are there, which is staff working in businesses in North Adelaide parking in short-term spaces. And the report recommends that we turn the remainder of McKinnon Parade, remembering part of it's been turned into a permit zone for nurses, returning the remainder of McKinnon Parade right out front the PAC development, with all of those residents who are really on side with council at the moment, into 5 and 10 hour parking. And it recommends also doing it on Mann Terrace and all the way along Kingston Terrace too, right up to Lefevre Terrace. Now, this is just a dynamite proposal, and this report recommends that council goes out to consultation, but I can provide some free advice. It won't fly. It will just anger businesses and residents. And moreover, the proposal to increase parking on Melbourne Street to our blocks is just going to encourage more of the same problem that we've got. That is staff parking on the street constantly and preventing customers for businesses from parking in the area and residents as well. So the likelihood is, if this is implemented, those 5 and 10 hour parks are going to be taken up by more of those people who are taking up the unrestricted spaces on Kingston Terrace and in other places to catch the free bus to come into town to do their work or whatever. It is just, you know, it's a backward proposal. And
it's not a proposal at all, Phil. It's just noting a report. There's no, I've removed the proposal, which was to do nothing.
Well, I think about it. It says quite clearly that notes that the key parking issue identified from the user perception surveys is insufficient long-term parking for workers in the precinct, and endorses the administration to consult.
That's been removed.
I thought you said you wanted it back in.
No.
4, 5, 6
we're
just laying a note out, and then we'll do what you want, and I want, so want later.
Oh, well,
you were about to lose everything until I removed it.
Okay, I'm sorry. I thought you were putting it back in.
No.
I can't read the board, I'm sorry.
I
apologise profusely to all of the members for wasting your time. I thought 6 was back in.
No. Okay.
Before we move, we've got two more speakers. Excuse me, we've got two more speakers who want to speak on this motion, but before we do that, we're bumping up against the other meeting, so I need someone to move an adjournment of this meeting. Mm-hmm. Moved by Councillor Cohen, seconded by Councillor Corbell. Can I put that we adjourn this meeting? All those in favour?
Declare the Finance and Business Services Committee meeting on Tuesday the 19th of April, open at 6:26 p.m. And I request that someone moves to adjourn. Moved by Councillor Malani, seconded by Councillor Antic. All those in favour? All those against? Meeting is adjourned.
So I'm now declare this meeting reopened, and we have got two more speakers who'd like to speak to this item, Councillor Wilkinson and the Lord Mayor.
Thank you, Deputy Lord Mayor. To inform Councillor Martin from the discussions last term, what was recommended was council to divest of this site altogether and thereby lose that parking provision for the Melbourne Street precinct. I strenuously argued against that and moved that not only should we not be divesting of it, but we should actually be increasing the size of the car park by going down and going up and doing some residential above to offset things so there's a net neutral position. So the Melbourne Street traders gain more car parking so that shop staff can park in the basement, residents park at first floor level, and shoppers then park at ground level with high value residential views above it to make it all stack up, and it would be done to a level that makes it stack up so that it's cost neutral for council and the ratepayers. We have a car park fund where development, which is short on parking, they pay money into a fund. We've got various main streets. Melbourne Street is one of them. This is the only opportunity that the Adelaide City Council has got to improve the parking situation. There wouldn't be a trader in the Melbourne Street thing that agrees with the statement in the report that says that there's not a parking problem in the area. They're all of the view that there's not enough parks. And having my business in that area, I'm cognizant of that myself. So I'm very happy to support the amendment, which basically keeps that option in play, because what's the point in us having a car parking fund and having land holdings if we actually don't do something with them to actually increase the amount of parking to provide for our various main streets? O'Connell Street is one that needs parking, Hutt Street is another one that needs parking, Melbourne Street. We have the land holding sufficient, we could triple the amount of parking on the site if we develop it properly, there's opportunity also to provide to our residential growth program as well, whilst we're doing that. So I'm certainly very keen to keep that in place, having support.
Lord Mayor.
Chair, my questions have been answered in the course of the debate, so I'm comfortable with this as it stands.
Councillor Malani, you reserved your right. Anybody else wish to speak to this? Otherwise, it's back to the mover.
Sunder.
So can I put that, all those in favour of the amended motion? That's carried, which brings us to the substantive. All those, that becomes the substantive, all those in the stone. No? All those opposed, substantive. That's carried. Brings us to item 11, exploration of a rainbow crossing in the city. And this has been called out by Councillor Martin, one of the greatest proponents.
Thank you, Chair. Look, I'd like to propose an amendment. If I could have a seconder, if someone will assist me. I want option 2A as set out in attachment B.
So you'd like to change paragraph 2 to read 2A rather than option 1?
Correct, option 2A.
Okay, so this is an alternate motion. Do I have a seconder for the alternate motion? No, that fails for lack of a seconder. Councillor Martin, I'm sorry.
Okay.
So members, that hasn't got up. Does anybody like to move? Councillor Moran?
I'll move as printed.
Move as printed. Seconded by? Councillor Malani?
I thought you were two.
Councillor Moran?
No, I don't think it's self-explanatory. Option one is obviously the cheap and cheerful.
Councillor Malani, do you have anything to add? Reserve your right. Anybody else wish to speak to this? Councillor Antic and Councillor Martin.
Thank you, Chair. It won't surprise anyone that I've long had a bee in my bonnet about this project, not, of course, because of the merits of it, it's lovely, but also because of the issue of the cost associated with it and the tough economic times we live in. The issue with this is, I think, that both options, neither of the options provide a really good outcome. We've got option one, which is a very simple, cheap and cheerful approach, which is going to require a lot of remediation work, touching up and all that sort of stuff. And then we've got option 2A, which is almost $100,000, which I've said from the get-go is just, I just can't understand why we are spending this sort of money on these sorts of projects in these sort of economic times. We've got other priorities that must be further down the tree now, so to speak. Now, I know that we've got a motion on the books that council commits to deliver the project, but if this motion doesn't get up, I'd foreshadow an amendment, which I can't speak to now at the moment, I suppose, but I certainly, can I move? Well, okay, I'll foreshadow it. If this doesn't, I will foreshadow an amendment in which 2 and 3 are replaced simply with a new 2, which says notes that none of the available options provide a suitable and cost-effective solution, and furthermore, the project be discontinued. I'll foreshadow to move that because I just don't see a viable option out of all of these. So.
Thank you, Councillor Andy. Councillor Martin?
I'm just appalled, absolutely appalled. I raised in this council a few weeks ago that we have a painted cheap and cheerful job on the footpath as a means of demonstrating to the wider community what the ultimate project would look like. And it was dismissed as inadequate by everyone in the room here. Everyone said, no, let's wait for the proper project. Now the proper project has come before you and people are saying, no, I don't want to commit to anything more than $21,000, or I don't want to commit to anything, as Councillor Antic is saying. Now look, this council, whether it likes it or not, reached a consensus in which it said, we want to celebrate diversity within the community in Adelaide. We want to say to the LGBTIQ community, we value your contribution to our society. Now we're saying, we reckon it's worth about $21,000, a cheap and cheerful job, or frankly, we don't give a damn, we'd rather have nothing. Now, there is a very clear proposal in here, identified at 2A, that says we can provide an alternative path of travel away from the busy roadway, invites pedestrians to move through the site with a new painted bitumen path, relocating existing furniture and a new tree planting, creating a new path offset by removing some of the existing paving. And it's noted at 18 that this is the higher quality option. So the choice, in my view, is you do the let's do nothing, or slap a bit of paint on the asphalt, for the LGBTI community and you say that's all you're worth, or you honour the commitment that you gave. And this council did give a commitment, whether it likes it or not, to provide some kind of recognition to the community in South Australia. Now, all this argument about cost is just a red herring. In fact, the money's already been allocated in the 15-16 financial year. It's already there, it's sitting in a budget, $90,000. You approved it, all of you approved it. It's not a new bid. And what the administration is saying is that the cost of option 2A is actually $74,000, not $100,000, because some of those costs are coming from other areas. So cost is not an argument. In fact, the administration is underspending by almost 20% of the budget. It's a long and tortuous path that we have been on with this rainbow walk. It is contentious, long running, and I think it's about time that people kept that commitment to the LGBTI community in South Australia and said, yes, we will deliver, not this, oh, well, we changed our mind stuff. I'm just appalled that anyone would propose that.
So I've got a number of speakers, Councillor Wilkinson, Councillor Corbell, Councillor Malani and Councillor Abbott. I would like Councillor Wilkinson first.
I'm happy for Councillor Corbell to go first.
Well, I would like to move an amendment, which is that we cross out option one and we endorse option 2A. But that's being crossed out. So I want to be clear about what.
So we had a councillor, Councillor Martin proposed that before we even took this motion on, and it didn't get a seconded.
Why?
I
still want to put it forward because I think option 2A is the better option. I'm sorry, I missed that opportunity.
Yep, you can still move it. So you're moving to amend, take out the one and reinstate 2A, and that will be second. No, you've spoken, Councillor Martin. Seconded by Councillor Vershaw.
Look, I think option 2A is definitely the way to go. It embodies what Councillor Sims originally wanted for this particular project, which is that it's consistent with the Adelaide Parklands Management Strategy, it's consistent with integrated design in the square, it provides additional shade and amenity within the square, it allows for future proofing, additional seating, lighting, it's aligned with asset renewals. For an extra $5,000, we can have some interpretation, which allows for storytelling and the milestones and the history of the LGBTIQ community. So it ticks all of the boxes. It's definitely the option that we should support. And I don't see any other option on the table. This is the one that all the councillors, all of the elected members should be supporting, is this one. It's cost effective and it ticks all the boxes. There's barely any cons to it at all. Slightly higher installation cost, but we've already addressed that over a year ago.
Councillor Vershaw, Councillor Malani, Councillor Moran.
Thank you, Chair. Sorry for the confusion. I actually thought we were trying to pass through the recommendation so that we could then have an amendment. So my apologies, Councillor Martin. Look, I also agree, I support Councillor Corbell. I do think it's a higher grade and more significant option that we should consider. I do note that it's a QF1 reconsideration that has been asked for. And I think to have the replanting, so there's at least a dozen chairs, plus the realignment, plus the upgrade, and the storytelling is worth us investing in.
Councillor Malai.
Thank you. Yes, I just want to clarify a comment particularly made by Councillor Martin about supporting diversity. For me, this is very much about supporting diversity, and I very much support the intent of Councillor Sims at the time, and I've always supported the Rainbow Crossing. But what we did actually, is the reason this has come back to this committee, is we did ask the administration to go away and explore more cost-effective ways to deliver this. Because as Councillor Manning says, we've got budget considerations, and of course we've got many groups that want to have something represented in the city. So I think that they did that quite well, and I thought they came up with a reasonably good solution. That's why we're having this conversation today, because this council, everyone here, agreed that we wanted to look at cost-effective ways of doing this. And just because, apart from Alex, of course, for different reasons, but just because we have budget doesn't mean we have to spend it. We always maintain that we can, whether it's other, you know, redevelopments, we've talked about council going away and having a look at cost considerations. That's a reasonable question for us to ask. They've come up with a good solution, and therefore I'm surprised that those that supported the request to go back to look at how we fund this and what the delivery options were to reduce costs are now saying, oh no, now we want the bells and whistles again and a $100,000 nearly, give or take, project. So I think that let's just trial this, let's just do it. Spend the $21,000. We're making a statement about diversity. It's a great statement to make. I don't agree with Alex on that, but and let's see what it brings. And if down the track we need to do something more, we can do that. But I think let's just start with this particular option. And I think we should all be proud that we are celebrating diversity in our city.
Councillor Moran, Councillor Wilkinson, Councillor Abbott.
As the mover, as the mover of the original motion, I don't know where we get that $21,000 isn't a lot of money. $21,000 is more than most people save in their entire working life. No, it's more than most people only save $10,000 in their life.
This no, is option one is $21,000 per annum.
No, it's not.
It has to be.
Oh, right. So it has to be 81. Councillor
Moran, please go ahead. Have to think about that. And what the 2A doesn't. No, 2A is a long
last. Can I ask the administration to clarify that?
Through the chair, it's not clear at this stage whether the repainting would cost the same amount, because it depends on the wear and tear over the course of the year, so we have to come back to you with
I suggest that it will last a bit longer than a year, and hopefully in the future the LGBTIQ community won't need. I mean, I'm not getting a middle-aged housewife walk, am I? Hopefully in the future they won't need that sort of validation, because it will be just a given that nobody, they don't feel they need it because they don't need it. So I'm quite happy with it not being forever, because I don't think it should be. We've come very far in our gender equality in a couple of generations. And I suspect that when my grandson grows up, if he's gay or not, it won't matter at all. So they'll wonder what this sort of funny archaic rainbow thing is, you know. Was there a time that people felt differently? So I'm happy with it being not forever, not in perpetuity. I'm about to move that we put in a safety temporary bike lane in Frome Road, and I know that the cost of that has already been raised. So I suggest that we have, sadly, much more important things than spending a squillion, nearly $100,000, Phil. That's a lot of money. I've never seen that much money. For something that I think is necessary now. I didn't when Rob first brought it up, but when I got the hideous homophobic texts and emails that we all got, I thought, no, that's true. But I think this will be gone in a generation. If this only lasts for a few years and we keep painting it, I don't know what paint you're using, it only lasts a year. I mean, our green bike paint lasts a bit longer than that. But I don't want it to be cheap and nasty either, but $21,000, I could put a swimming pool in for that. That's a lot of money. I don't know what I can possibly
remember. That's what you're telling
me. That's it. But so look, I don't think anybody here really agrees that we are being insensitive to the gay community by not spending a lot of money. I think they haven't put any money in, but they'd like us to. I think we're giving a proportional amount of our ratepayers' money, mostly will be on board, but not for a huge amount of money, to give a lovely gesture of unification and recognition of the problems they have. This will do it. I don't think that, this is offensive to have $21,000, not $74,000. I think it's a little bit offensive to spend $74,000. It's too much. I don't think it should be permanent.
Councillor Wilkinson, then Councillor Abbott.
When I was initially looking at these options, I was feeling that option one gave us the gesture at a lesser cost. But then, you know, I'm learning that option one is something that's going to be currently repainted. I would rather us do the better, more permanent paint, so we're not continuing, because it's a false economy if we have to keep repainting. The other thing is looking at the plans. If you look on page 57, for example, option two and 2A includes the interpretation, which I think is important to have that interpretation. We're going to do this. People need to know why it's there as an educational thing, otherwise it's all a bit of a pointless exercise. But option two, it actually looks like a rainbow with the arc like that. So, you know, I think that makes more sense. If we're going to do it, I think we should do it properly. And we have previously made the undertaking. We were as barraged with the hate campaign from the religious right when we previously dealt with this issue, which I think galvanised some of our opinions to support it. So I'm supporting the option 2A, which looks like a rainbow and will be a bigger upfront spend, but without the ongoing maintenance thing, which would make us rely on a false economy.
Councillor Haggard.
Thank you, Chair, Deputy Lord Mayor Hender. Look, I don't think this should be done cheaply. I don't think anything we do in this city should be done cheaply. We should do things properly. However, I'd like to bring the attention of members to the original motion that was moved in relation to this. It didn't commit funds. It looked at ways and how we can fund it. And one of the things that was brought and it was negotiated at the time, and I did with Councillor Sims because I moved it as an amendment, was for us to look at options on how the community can assist with this, whether it be a crowdfunding exercise, something online, where the community can get involved and co-fund with us. I bring to your attention Chinatown, bring to your attention a lot of other projects within multicultural and acceptance community within Adelaide, where we didn't put out the whole funds. And I think it's crucial that the community takes part ownership over this. It's an important issue, and assist in some type of co-funding. I think that's still not responded to in any of the motion. However, originally the first motion did indicate for us to look at ways on how the community can be involved in funding. So as we can look today, it's either council funds the whole lot or not. I don't think that should be the case. I think we should do this. We should present this to the community as a package. We should make an educational exercise over the next few months and assist the community in raising some money. I know a lot of people that will be prepared to put in $50 here, $100 there, be part of this Pride Walk or Pride Path or whatever you want to call it. And I think council can, with that, assist. So look, with that, I'd like to consider, I would like to put through an amendment for the Adelaide City Council to note the three options presented.
Just a moment, Councillor, we're going to have to deal with this amendment first, so if you can foreshadow that you...
Okay, so I would like to foreshadow that we support option 2A. Council commits $50,000 of funding and looks to the community to support the remainder, $24,000 or $25,000, whatever it is. I think that is a fair outcome. It gives the community ownership over this project. We have a lot to celebrate in the way of history, as Councillor Currahan mentioned before, in relation to diversity in the city of Adelaide. And look, I do think it will be important to note sometimes, and I really hope Councillor Moran is right, there will become a time where this is just accepted and it will be fine for us to still have a monument to remind people of how times used to be and what history was like. And sometimes history is cruel to a lot of people. So look, it's important that this would set a reminder for us in the future that diversity is important in the city of Adelaide from a multicultural perspective, from a same-sex perspective. There's a billion reasons to why we should support diversity. So that's what I'm flagging if this motion fails, that I would be moving in that path. And look, I definitely think it's a worthwhile project and shouldn't go back in the closet.
Councillor Maloney, just a question.
Ask a question. My question is, when we paint lines on a road, we don't paint them every year. Why is this different? What's different about it?
Thank you.
Through the chair, the options presented before you, option one is basically the lightest spec paint we can get for that extent of works. Hence the desire that it's 12 months, reviewed after 12 months. The other options are a high spec paint. A much higher spec paint will last longer. That's the fundamental difference.
That's the fundamental difference.
Correct.
Thank you. Councillor O'Farahan, you wish to speak?
Yes. How much are we putting in for the artwork out the front of the town, out the front of the Perry Street building?
That's a question for the administration.
To the chair, 150,000.
Have we asked communities to raise money for artworks before? Can someone give us an example of where that's happened? Or are we into now crowdfunding for all our artworks?
What about the deceased workers?
We've had that as a rhetorical question, but I don't think we've got an answer for you, Councillor Clarahan.
Okay. Look, I take on board what Councillor Aviad has said in terms of acknowledging and celebrating diversity. I think it is very important. And it certainly harks back to the European settlement of this colony when a lot of our own ancestors came out fleeing persecution and they found a free place and a safe place to be. But unfortunately, even though some of our, descendants of those people have issues around acceptance, and I think it would be really offensive to this community for us to ask them to raise money for the Rainbow Walk. We were at the forefront in terms of changing legislation, decriminalising homosexuality, at great sacrifice, given that we did lose one of our academics from Adelaide University, and another who happened to survive, but still wears the scars today, of people who cannot accept diversity. And I think this wouldn't be a good look for our council if we can't provide a reasonable quality symbol of our acceptance of diversity in this city. It's something we should be celebrating, not trying to hide under cheap paint.
Not okay, so I think we've had most people speak to the amendment. So, Councillor Corbell, unless anybody else wishes to speak, back to you as mover. Okay, so can I put the amendment, which is to endorse option 2A, all those in favour? All those against?
Division.
That's carried.
Division. Did you say?
All those members in favour, please rise. The Chair, Deputy Lord Mayor, Councillor Clarahan, Councillor Martin, Councillor Wilkinson, Councillor Corbell, Councillor Shaw.
That becomes the amended motion. Councillor Aviad foreshadowed second amendment. Councillor Abbott?
Sorry?
That becomes the amended motion, but you foreshadowed we've had one amendment. That becomes a substantive. As I understand it, we're entitled to have a second amendment.
Not the shadow.
Councillor Antic indicated that he had a second amendment to move. He was the first person to indicate that. So I think he gets an opportunity to put that amendment, as long as it's not a direct negative to the motion in front of us.
No, it's not.
So, okay, please, you're entitled to do it.
So if he's fails, we can't put another amendment up.
Well, perhaps the terminology is incorrect, so he's entitled to remove another motion. So, please go ahead.
All right, well, mine is to remove item two. And, oh, hang on, there it is, it's already up. Mine was notes that none of the available options provide a suitable and cost-effective solution, and furthermore, that the project be discontinued. That is not enough.
So is there a second of that, Chair?
There's no second there.
We're just getting some advice, but to me, that...
That's not...
So my advice is that the direct negative and therefore can't be put. In any event, I think it fails for want of a second, to be honest. So that gives us another opportunity for a second amendment. And Councillor Abiad, you indicated you would like to...
Look, I'll attempt this, but notes, I'm hoping that council next might have an extra councillor who can get it through, but item one to stay as it is, noting the three options. Item two to endorse option 2A for the Rainbow Walk in Light Square, blah, 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 as there. And council commit $50,000 to the project. And then the new part three. Engage the community at large and assist them in a crowdfunding exercise. To co-fund and co-partner with the project. And then the new, well, the old three would be part four.
So that's the second amendment. Do I have a seconder for it, please? No, that fails.
No, it hasn't. Huh? Can I, I'm going to second that with a condition for you to potentially vary,
yep.
Councillor Abiad. That in the event that a crowdfunding exercise is unsuccessful, the council proceeds on a budget of $50,000.
No, that's fine.
I'm not sure what he said.
Yeah, wasn't me. Big series of council members.
So, members, we now need to get the wording of the motion up.
On a budget not exceeding
$50,000.
And I'll speak to that one.
Okay.
No. So, we get the wording up, Jane?
No, yeah, that's just the Lord Mayor's wording, sorry.
So where do you want that, Lord Mayor?
In the appropriate place, it would be engaged community large to assist them in crowdfunding exercise to co-fund and partner with the project. However, should that exercise be unsuccessful, comma, the council proceed with the project with a budget not exceeding $50,000. And I'll speak to it after Councillor Abiad spoke.
I'm happy to reserve my mind.
So that has been moved by Councillor Abiad and seconded by the Lord Mayor. Lord Mayor. Councillor Abiad has reserved his right. Do you wish to speak to it?
Lord Mayor.
Thank you, Chair. I think there is merit in what Councillor Abiad is suggesting in terms of engaging with the community, because I think it will provide ownership and buy-in and participation in this project. And councillors, you know that there are many projects whereby we will jointly partner with others in order to expedite the project, and I think this could be one of them. But however, recognising that may not be successful, I don't think it should jettison the project. So that's why I'm putting the safeguard mechanism here that for a budget not exceeding $50,000, this project proceeds at council's cost should Councillor Abiad's endeavours be unsuccessful, which I'm not suggesting they will be. I actually think it would enhance the project. I genuinely mean that. But nonetheless, the project must continue otherwise. That's my view.
We've got a request for some administrative comment regarding scope and timing.
Through the Chair, without entering into the debate, just a couple of points to be aware of. We would come back to council to rescope the project if the budget was $50,000, and so that would add to the time that would take. And we also have the October deadline that we're aiming for in terms of the coinciding with the Feast Festival. So just a couple of observations in terms of that.
Thank you.
if no one else is speaking,
yeah, I've got a couple of other people who want to speak.
I'll speak there and then I'll sum up at the end. Look, I'm very confident that the community will come up with funds. I know for a fact that the minute the social media campaign launches, we're talking about a federal issue here, that federal government's debating this. People all over Australia will engage in this issue. It will put Adelaide on the map. It will put South Australia on the map. And people will be talking about this online, on social media. And the people that are very passionate about this issue and the people that are not will have a chance to make and be part of history and engage and invest in a... In this diversity walk. And I think it's really important that we give people that opportunity to take ownership and be part of it. I mean, anyone can donate $50, $100, and people can walk proudly after that and feel that I've done something different. They might want to wait for the state government to put in a plebiscite or whatever they want, but on a community level, they will feel engaged, they will feel involved, there will be fundraising exercises, and this will give an opportunity for this exercise to go on and be part of a community change where people are having a debate and having a discussion about it. And I think that's really, really important to note. Otherwise, all we're doing is painting the road, having the Lord Mayor cut a ribbon on top of it, talk about it, and move on. That's it. That's all that's going to happen. Some people are going to take photos of it, and it's done. Let's be part of that change where we can allow people to be part of change. And I think it's really important that we bring that about. So, look, I urge members to support this. I'm confident the money will be raised. I'm confident it will happen in no time. Some crowdfunding exercises raise even more money than this. You'll be surprised how much money will come out of this. This is happening all over the world where people get engaged in crowdfunding exercises for things that they're passionate about and they want to be part of and have ownership in. So look, I think this has merit, it has social media merit, and it has also some international effects as a result. I think it will spread, it will go viral, and I think it's one of those things that will put Adelaide on the map as being a city that's engaged and will put part of the community. And look, I'll be honest with you, there's a lot of issues happening globally at the moment. I'll pull my hand up as an Australian Muslim. There will come a time, Adelaide is the first ever city in Australia to have a mosque, for example, in 1861 to be built. I mean, if the community was to come with a $100,000 request, I would tell them, I would have told my own community in the past, that any installation, they need to co-fund, they need to co-assist, just like I've told the Chinese community, just like I've told the Indian community. And I'll do the same thing with the LGBTIQ community as well. I think it's important that they take part ownership and be part of the process and part of the partnership. I think it's crucial because 100 years from today, they can talk about how they fundraised, how they were involved in community engagement. And there is a story in that, a very important story in that. So members, I think this is maybe a spark for council to work on projects with communities where we could co-fund, but there is a process now, there's social media, there's engagement tools. We didn't have any of that in the past. So look, I urge members to support this amendment.
So councillors, speaking to the amendment, Councillor Antic, Councillor Martin, then I think Councillor Tarrant has his hand.
Thank you, Chair. Look, once again, I won't support this. And I want to be very clear about the reasons for this. We are, at the end of the day, a local government. We are about painting zebra crossings, filling in roads, doing footpaths, and there is a hierarchy of need in terms of costs. So my objection to this is solely on the grounds of commercial priority, I suppose. And I really do wonder how it is that we spend 2 weeks ago at this very room, we spent something like 45 minutes debating whether or not we continue on with the waste management service, which is, of course, under the roads rates rubbish approach to local government. And we then turn around and we have said, no, we're going to do a completely different way in terms of picking up rubbish. And instead of that, we're going to spend money painting lines on a road, which, as meritorious as it may well be, and it is, we all celebrate diversity. There's no question about that. I think that what is lacking sometimes is a pragmatic approach to the cost effectiveness of a project. And that's my concern. I've said it time and time again, I've been consistent about it. I've probably worn the slings and arrows of having a closed mind about it. I don't, but I simply don't see it as a priority. So once again, I think I'll stand out as a lone voice on that one, but I'm quite prepared to do so. And by all means, if other communities want to have a similar sort of arrangement, I would make the same observation. So I just don't think that's what we're about.
Councillor Martin.
Thank you, Chair. Look, I hear what Councillor Antic and Councillor Abiyad are saying. I can see their lips moving, but there's not much sense coming out of their mouths. They are talking about applying to one particular section of the community, the LGBTIQ community, a proposal that they're not applying to others. Now, these are the very same councillors that didn't see crowdfunding for the deceased workers' memorial. That was pretty good. There was no argument about the memorial for children who were adopted. And I didn't hear any of them say, look, the $1 million that we're putting into Kintore Avenue to commemorate the Anzacs of this country, we might go and get some crowdfunding for that too.
Yeah, it's co-funded.
Yeah. Well, it's not crowdfunded at all. That's misleading. I mean, that's the sort of stuff that's being fed up tonight. It is a joint project between the state, federal, and Adelaide City Council. That's not crowdfunding. And what you're saying is, let's put this out to the community. This is the same community at large, as you refer to it, that contacted Councillor Moran with threats, that sent me emails as well, denigrating what we were doing and denigrating the LGBTIQ community. These are the people you're going to. This is what you're seeking to do, to open up the whole debate. Now, let's just put this in some context. This was about this council establishing a memorial, if you like, to the moment in time 40 years ago when this state acted to decriminalise homosexuality, and at the same time to indicate to the LGBTIQ community that there was, on the part of this council, a gratitude for their contribution to our society. Now we seek to demean that by saying we'll go out and get some crowdfunding for it. We're applying rules to one section of the community that we are not applying to others. And if people take something in that, if there's an inference in that, who can blame them? This is not a community project. It's not a swimming pool or a petanque piste. This is actually about a council saying, we recognise the contribution of a section of the community and we want to say so loudly and clearly. It's pretty straightforward to me, and any other part that's suggested is going to amount to some kind of backflip on the proposal that came forward and that was welcomed by the community. I must say, I find it extraordinary that people who I generally regard as having such astute political ears and judgment are making that kind of judgment.
We think we need to play the ball up the man.
Yeah,
have Councillor Clarahan.
Look, I think we've gone too far down the track to think about crowdfunding. I think crowdfunding is a very useful tool, but it needs to be a decision that we make up front and not down the track. And I think we've gone too far with this process to actually make it look like there's good intent. I think the danger we've got here is that we're looking like we're Scrooges. We're looking like we're being mean-spirited. Half-hearted is not going to wash, I don't think, with our LGBTIQ community. This same community are residents, they're property owners, they're students, they're workers, they're visitors to the city. And I think that we need to stand up and not provide a half-hearted gesture that is a symbol of our supposed celebration of diversity and acceptance. The next thing we'll be looking at is maybe leaving a few colours out of the rainbow. Maybe that'll bring the price down a bit and help some people support it. I somehow don't think that the cost is the real issue.
Councillor Maloney?
Well, I just want to say that I think the crowdfunding idea is a good one, but I'm probably not in this context, but I urge Councillor Abiad, maybe another business, for us to set up a crowdfunding policy on crowdfunding so that we can actually use this as a lens to consider for other projects in the future.
Okay. Members, can I put the amendment? Councillor Abbott, it was your amendment to sum up.
Just got to say, I'm a little bit offended by Councillor Martin's remark that he's put me and Alex in the same boat. But look, just in response briefly to Councillor Clarahan, I have been very consistent with this. The first motion we moved was one of the lines of the motion referred to crowdfunding specifically. So before even the inception of this program, when Councillor Sims came to me and said, look, what do you think? Councillor Sims at the time, I said, look, happy to support it. Let's do a crowdfunding exercise. If you're happy to put that as an amendment in the motion, I will support your motion. So that's been in the motion from day dot. So look, I wouldn't accept today that it was brought upon council at the last minute and the last second. This was done from last year, it was original, and it was part of the motion. So please take that into account, because that was the motion that everyone voted for at council, was for us to engage the community and be part of a crowdfunding exercise, Councillor Martin. You did vote for it, and I can remind you of that and bring it up for you. So that was initially the discussion we've had, and that's how we got the motion on the board. But look, at the end of the day, I think we all want to see this done in different ways. I was to ask members to support this and look at ways on how we could move. And look, I agree with Councillor Milani, there might be opportunities of crowdfunding later. But look, please take this into account, and let's just engage with the community and see how we go with it. At the end of the day, the $50,000 is there, we can spend it, we can deliver this anyway.
So members, we're now voting on the second amendment. So all those in favour of the second amendment, please. All those against? That's not carried. Which brings us back to the substantive. So everybody clear that that's 2A without needs crowdfunding. Does anybody wish to speak to any of that, or fully canvass the issues? Okay, can I put the motion? All those in favour? All those against? That's carried.
I've got a division on that.
Division?
All those in favour, please rise.
Division? Did anyone take division?
Yes, all those in favour of the motion, please rise. We've been asked.
The Chair, Councillor Milani, Councillor Clarahan, Councillor Martin, Councillor Wilkinson, Councillor Corbell, Councillor Bishop.
Okay, members, thank you for that exhaustive debate. Moves us to item 12. Councillors, in order to expedite item 12, I'm going to ask administration to come and just give us a quick rundown on where this project is at. I've had some conversations with a number of councillors. I'd like to hear. So if we could just get a 2 or 3 minute rundown on where we are with Wilcox, Little Sturt and Chatham Street Improvement Project, particularly in light of the budget. So if you could, we can hand over to you. Members, can we just have your attentions? This is an important item. We need to get a grip on this.
Through the chair, so did you want the history of the project? Or?
As I understand it, some of the project has already been undertaken. A very brief history of what's been done, what is proposed to be done, and how that ties in with the budget process, because this is also a budget.
Yeah, correct. So the project commenced in 2014 when the Department of Transport approached us on the Sturt Street Community Way to Go, or Sturt Street Community School Way to Go program. And that also formed part of our priority walking and cycling link in the city west link. So we took the opportunity to collaborate with them on some infrastructure upgrades. So some of the key issues that came out of the school was there's a lot of school children that are walking from the school through Little Sturt Street as well as Wilcox to the Princess Elizabeth's playground. Through that project, as I said, that it was a priority walking and cycling link, so we were looking at opportunities of how we could collaborate to improve both the cycling, so a lot of the streets there are one way and they're just low speed traffic streets with low traffic volumes. And as part of the project, we consulted with the community to upgrade Wilcox Street, which is just a small section of the footpath, also to install a zebra crossing, wombat crossing on Gilbert Street, and we also implemented contraflow facilities along Little Sturt Street as part of that consultation and project. And the majority of that work, if not all of it, it was about 50,000, majority of that work was funded by state government. So it was about 70-30% split.
And that work's been completed?
That work, Gilbert Street zebra crossing was just completed last week. And so yes, all that work's been completed now.
So this is stage 2.
Yes, and so what we took was the opportunity that this work had already commenced was an opportunity to extend that link up to Grove Street.
That we had received some complaints from Little Sturt Street about the types of treatments that were put in because they were low cost. There was requests for some greening as well along the street. And so when we put the initial budget up, we also applied for state government grant as part of the 15-16 budget bid. We were looking at more the low cost functional treatments to improve the walking and cycling environment, and hence why we came up with that 390 budget in the 15-16 financial year. But as we were saying, as we were having conversations around the Russell on Compton project, people were seeking better outcomes from a residential perspective or street improvements, and because a lot of the project was just chevron line marking. So if you look at Sturt Street on Russell on Compton, there's just a lot of chevrons through there. People were criticising it, the island blobs, and people were seeking better outcomes from a pedestrian and public realm rather than just a functional design. And so we came up applying some of the Adelaide Design Manual principles to improve the street, or to improve the street environment. And so we were conscious about some of the costings associated with that. So we took it up to council in December 2015 before we went out to consultation, seeking endorsement to consult on those designs. The consultation was undertaken in February. We received some strong community support for the improvements. There was some concern around the parking, so we've made some amendments to the design. And as part of that, as part of the budget bid in December, we also highlighted to council that we would need to seek additional budget in 16-17 budget process to complete the project up to Grove Street. And so that's where we are now, where we've consulted, we've got the community feedback, we revised the concept based on the feedback that we received, but we don't have enough budget as indicated in this financial year to complete it, so we're seeking budget next financial year.
Okay, thank you for giving us that background and putting it in some context for us. So members, over to you. Lord Mayor.
Thanks, Chair. I called this out because, in fact, I wanted to invite Tanya to speak to it. So thank you. I appreciate that.
You're going to move it, Lord Mayor?
I will, but I'd just like to make some comments first, if I can, please.
No.
Chair. Okay, look, I'll move this print in a moment and talk to it.
Okay, so moved by the Lord Mayor, seconded by Councillor.
Thank you. Thank you, Chair. The Owen Russell Compton piece, which I had a look at over the weekend, you've been taking on board feedback from that project progressively as it's been done. That thinking's been factored into this project. This project is part of an associated schools program.
It is part of the strategy of priority walking and cycling links, of getting people to walk on the small street, to cycle and walk on the small streets rather than Morford, so providing a low stress environment. So it did initiate from the Way to Go program, but it was also a combination of projects that instigated it.
Okay, and this is of course within proximity of Sturt Street primary.
Correct. Yeah. Right.
Okay.
So the initiator.
You're overcoming my concern. My concern, of course, was the proximity of this project compared to the Owen Russell Compton project, which would be 150 metres away at best, is further east. So this project was done. This is my point of concern, which I'd like to satisfy. That's why I drew this out. Is that this project was specifically done with due regard to the school?
Correct.
Is that correct?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. Okay, on that basis, I'm satisfied. Can I just ask a question of the CEO then? Thank you, CEO. This matter comes before us in terms of a budget bid at the following meeting. So, because I think we got to page 9 on workshop papers, and I don't think we got to this item as yet. So the decision that's made here tonight, how does that inform the budget bid papers, which we will talk about in the workshop and then Julie in consultation committee, then chamber. I just want to see how they interrelate. That's all.
Mark, can you help us out?
Adrian, can you help us out?
Through the chair, recommendation 3 of this report simply says notes that a budget is proposed as part of the integrated business plan, and so that is put in there just to To say that there isn't a budget decision being made as part of this report, and that will come up in the business plan discussion.
All right, on that basis, I'm satisfied. Thank you.
Councillor Moran, seconded you. Councillor Wilkinson.
Yeah, thank you, Deputy Lord Mayor. Looking at the plans for these streets, you know, there's a considerable budget associated with doing all of this. And I can see that what's motivating these capital works is making these contra-flow bike lanes. So that's really the main driver, but whilst improving the streets whilst you're at it. But there seems to be a lot of use of sort of paved sections of road. And then there are a lot of sections where there are no trees, you know, like on Little Sturt Street on the western side. You see, and then the trees are cut out, you know, two-thirds of the way down the street. And I would rather see us do less paving and more trees. And other members of council, and when we've been talking about our strategic plan and stuff like that, we've been singing, I think, for the same hymn sheet in terms of we want to see, if we're going to be spending ratepayers' money on urban initiatives, we want as many trees for this as possible. And it seems we've got you know, these paved sections are pretty expensive to do, and I'd rather see us pull back on those to, and then divert that funding to more trees so that you get an avenue effect. So when you're riding along these streets, it's actually shaded the whole way, rather than imagine on a hot day, you get two-thirds of the way along the street and then it's hot as Hades because the avenue cuts out two-thirds of the way along the street. So
perhaps we can get a response to that, Councillor Wilkinson.
And then I'm considering an amendment to try.
Through the chair, the paving sections that you see on Little Sturt Street and Chatham Street intersections are existing pavement. So the only place where we're proposing to put pavement treatments is on Chatham Street, where the children's pick up and drop off is, and that's purely because we've received complaints from parents about vehicles going quite fast through there, and it doesn't provide a proper delineation. So instead of just putting some line marking, we looked at an opportunity to enhance that space and to calm traffic. The other location will propose pavings on Wilcox Street, and that was just to replace the existing street art that had been installed as part of the Sturt Street Community School. And that was an excellent initiative, but it's also quite expensive to replace on a continuous basis, because obviously the street art has a short lifetime.
And Tanya, if you'd like to comment on the tree planting.
So with the tree planting, we looked at every opportunity to put as many trees as possible. So with the Little Sturt Street, we actually engaged with the community and the residents on the street. I think Councillor Corbell may have been involved with some of those discussions as to where, because obviously there's with tree plantings, it also impacts on parking. So that was negotiated with the residents and we came to a compromise solution. We have proposed some additional trees on Chatham Street by narrowing the footpath where the children's pick up and drop off is, and that's highlighted in the report, but there was some concern because it's a one-way street, the parents actually have to pick up the children from the roadside or take the children out of their car from the roadside, so we couldn't include the widening of footpath to include the greening. And on Wilcox Street as well, we're proposing some additional trees, but there was resistance against the loss of parking. So we've looked at every opportunity to increase the landscaping where possible. And those pavement sections are really just existing with the exception of the ones that I've just mentioned.
Okay, thank you for that response. Looking at the plan of Chatham Street, I can only see one tree on the corner of Wright Street at that end. The balance of Chatham Street on the plan I'm looking at, there are no trees at all.
Yeah, correct. Well, we looked at every opportunity. Where we're providing is at the intersection approaches. We were looking at some widening of footpath to increase the tree, but that was rejected because of we needed to keep the wide parking spaces. So we can look at other opportunities. I'm not sure if this plan clearly articulates the width of the footpath because we did look at opportunities, but we could relook at that as part of the design.
Okay, so it's only Wilcox Street where we're adding a bit of paving.
Correct. And
so
that
we
section...
could do that. We could just do that in bitumen and then put that money towards some trees.
Correct, we could. Yeah.
Okay. Perhaps if I could just move an amendment, hopefully we've got some support. That the paving in Wilcox, the new paving in Wilcox.
One moment, Councillor, we just work out where this is going. Is it replacing or is it in addition to?
In addition to. That any new paving, including the new paving in Wilcox Street, the. Deleted. Except for the child drop-off in Chatham Street, and that, accepting that child drop-off. And that the additional funds they put towards maximising the number of new street trees to form a canopy over the street.
Okay, so we've captured your amendment adequately.
Yes, thank you.
So
I hope I've captured the sentiment
for that.
Members. Yes, so in speaking to that, a number of us have spoken about our desire to try and get as many trees in without greening the city, and the southwest corner of the city is the portion of the city that needs greening the most. I think the nicest street in the southwest corner is North Street, which is planted with Gloditzia trees form a lovely shade canopy over the street, and they go continuously for the length of the street, not just the two thirds of the length of the street. And I think North Street, with those Gloditzia trees, with the lovely shady ambience that provides, is the sort of real greening, as opposed to sticking the pot plant in front of the Colonel Larson, that we should be looking at doing. Thank you.
Councillor Martin.
No, reserve my rights.
Administration, do you want to make some comments? I've got some contact down there.
Through the chair, just quickly again, not entering the debate, just would like to make it clear that the administration will certainly look for opportunities for additional trees, but at this stage, not in a position to guarantee that, given the balance that is being sought, especially around parking. But certainly will endeavour to find opportunities.
Councillor Wilkinson, the administration has suggested that rather than have your amendment at the very end of the as an additional paragraph, that it actually be incorporated in paragraph two where the design element is
very
discussed.
Happy.
Are you content with that?
Yes.
And Councillor Moran, are you also content with that? Councillor Martin, are you content with that as a seconder? Thank you. So I don't think we need to put that variation, do we? Okay, Councillor Bishop.
Excuse me if I'm just a little bit confused, because I walk down that street all the time because my office is around the corner. So is there a removal of trees going to be happening in Chatsworth?
No.
Or is this just showing where you're putting additional trees?
Correct. Yeah, there's no removal of trees.
Okay, because there are trees.
Yeah, no, that's
street.
What I thought. I was
and
looking
so,
at the design and I was concerned.
And I'm looking at this and going, well, that's why I just checked the map, because maybe I'm looking at the wrong street, because I walk down that street all the time.
I was conscious about that as well, looking at the design.
Thank you.
Perhaps we get some clarity between now and the council.
Council
meeting.
How many trees?
Yes.
And we'll update the plan if there are trees.
Okay, thank you. Does anybody else wish to speak to this?
Can I just have a little bit more clarification on whether the paving, change in paving, was serving any safety issues?
Through the chair, the intent of the paving is to encourage slower speeds. There is some evidence-based that it does encourage slow speeds, but the current traffic speed volumes indicate that speeds are relatively low down there anyhow. The paving was there just to provide a compensation for the removal of street art that was endorsed as part of the Sturt Street Community School. And it was also to improve the amenity of the street to reduce the amount of asphalt on those residential streets.
Thank you.
Councillor Corbell.
This is just a question. I'm looking at attachment C on Wilcox Street, and it's got underneath, it says there's a caption that says trees to be removed. But there are trees that are going in, but are there also trees being removed?
Yes, I do apologise, and it's probably something that we need to update. Originally, we were proposing for those three trees to be removed, and I think we didn't remove that particular commentary. Because as we say in number two, trees and parking to be retained, no change based on consultation feedback. So what we had proposed was to remove those three trees which are currently impacting on accessibility and to relocate them into the street. But we received quite strong feedback about the loss of parking in that area. So we said that we'll leave it as it is for now. And it's something that we can review sometime later in the future. So we'll update those plans.
Okay, councillors, anybody else wish to speak to the amendment? Then back to Councillor Wilkinson to sum up.
Yes, the trees that Councillor Bershaw referred to in Chatham Street that are not shown on the plan, for the most of the length of the street are a species which don't really afford much or any shade for pedestrians. That's why I specifically referred to the gluditsias in North Street, which is a narrow street. They're close to buildings, obviously works. That provides genuine shade and cooling for the city, which the crape myrtle trees, whilst they've got pretty flowers on them, don't afford any shade or any cooling effect to the city. It's going to be about greening. I think any the people in the street which might be losing the street, I would rather more trees in their street than paved in lieu of trees.
Okay, members, can I put the amendment? All those in favour? All those against? Sorry, let's do that again. All those in favour of the amendment? Is that carried? All those against? Okay, that's carried. The amendment is carried. That becomes the substantive. Does anybody wish to have any further discussion on this? Councillor Corbell.
I just want to say thank you, because I know that a lot of work's gone into this, and there's been so much cry from the community to have more trees put in and to have these upgrades made to the street to make it more accessible and easy to get around and navigate, and it ticks so many boxes, and it's going to make a lot of people in the southwest happy.
On that charming note, can I put the substantive motion? All those in favour? That is carried. Thank you. Thank you, councillors. Thank you, administration. That brings us to item 14, out of session information papers to note. And that was called out by Councillor Martin, who I think had a question in relation to the fifth paper.
Yes, thank you, Chair. Look, it's a very simple question. I note at 14 it says the results of the survey of evaluating the program were limited. I wondered, is there any way that you can get the fringe dollars back, or there's some way for that to come back to council so you can ascertain the success, but, or is it much harder than that?
Through the chair, yeah, it's quite difficult because 100,000 were distributed, and we have had some of the businesses that participate retain them and feed the quantity and number back. It is a fair part of the project is in regards to the marketing and the support that it services that it provides to businesses. So it'd be difficult.
Okay, that's my question. Thank you.
I've got another question, but before I do that, move to that, can somebody move the, someone happy to move? Thank you. Moved by Councillor Martin, seconded by Councillor Bershaw. Councillor Martin, did you wish to speak to anything else? Councillor Bershaw?
Thank you. Through the chair, it's a great project. My question is that, and that's fantastic that you're supporting the Fringe in this way, is are there similar projects in the pipeline to support the Adelaide Festival, which is also on at the same time?
Through the chair, what we did this year was work more broadly across all fixed business in the city to talk to them about various mechanisms, not just to work or support or activate through the Fringe, but also through other activities that were happening through the city, not just during that period, but also other times of the year, such as when there's football on, cricket and other activities. So while this report talks to the Fringe, we have tried to make effort to make sure that we're talking to other major events as well as other activities.
So in terms of, there's an allocation in here, so there was $30,000 spent on this project and an allocation within city activation for $30,000 next year. Is that again specific to the Fringe project? And so second to that, is there other monies allocated for the other festivals?
Not directly to other festivals, but the majority of the work is picked up through marketing the other activities, so particularly the football season and other things happening in the city.
Members, unless anybody else has got some questions or councillors, sorry, my side was out loud, I beg your pardon. Councillor Wilkinson, I didn't mean to discourage him.
Thank you, Deputy Lord Mayor. Just on the item three there about the Beatles, being a Beatles fan, I'd just like to bring to members and galleries interest the fact that we're celebrating the Beatles coming to Adelaide. And the celebration of that. The Adelaide Town Hall is actually the only building associated with their visit that actually still stands. They stayed at the South Australia Hotel that was demolished by ANZAC in the 70s for the brown pebble finished Gateway Hotel, which I'm sure tourists come to Adelaide to see the brown pebble finished Gateway Hotel opposite Parliament House. And Centennial Hall, which was demolished only
Chair, we'll have a budget discussion later. This is not relevant to the budget.
A few years ago.
This is not relevant. Just a point of order, Chair, please. Like, we have a long night ahead of us, and this has no relevance to the commemoration of the Beatles.
Councillor Wilkinson, do you think you can just bring it to a close very quickly, please? Make your point.
Centennial Hall, where they play, was demolished just a few years ago based on cooked up allegations about having concrete.
Okay, thank you very much. Members, can I put item 14 to you? All those in favour? All those against? That's carried. And we now move to item other business. Does anybody have, item 15, Councillor Moran.
Yes.
Yeah, I move the motion printed to paint a temporary bike lane on Pirie Street, on the Pirie Street North Terrace section of Frome Road to alleviate the dangerous situation that now exists. I really don't feel I need to debate this. I mean, we know that the final solution is yet to come, and all of us disagree or have different views on that. But at the moment, for nearly 18 months, a terribly dangerous situation has existed where tourists and people are encouraged to go on the safest bike lane in South Australia, Australia, and then after a couple of hundred metres, they're disgorged into open traffic. It's an accident waiting to happen. I want it on the record that I want it fixed now. It's up to your nervousness about the situation to support it, but I urge us to support it.
Councillor Martin, a seconder.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. Councillor Moran may not be aware, but the administration has agreed with her, and just before we met, distributed some options to implement what it is she's asking for. However, as I received it at the last minute, I cannot discern or visualise what is actually proposed, and so I wonder, before we basically instruct the administration to proceed with this, if I could have an explanation for each of the options that have been outlined in their response to item 15.
Councillor
So this is something recently distributed, Councillor Martin, I've seen.
Yes, there was a response to Councillor Moran's motion, which came out late this afternoon. Just before the meeting, I saw it. It may have been out a little earlier, but okay. And there are some options here. And I wasn't able immediately before the meeting to see them, and that's what I'd like to see with an explanation.
So just for some clarity, members, this is because the links that were embedded in the administrative response to item 15 didn't work or weren't working for those of us who had iPads. And so they have apparently printed off the images that were behind those links. And they're here for distribution.
Can I just suggest a way out, if I get some dodges, that hopefully you vote for my motion and we send it to council to decide which option. Yes. I mean, I'm not fussed. I just want us to do something yesterday. So
yes, that would be good. That would give us time.
So if somebody, I can't change because this is a motion on notice, but if somebody can amend mine that we endorse this motion, vote for this motion and set and explore options as put up by the, because my motion only sent the answers to me, and I don't think we should decide on the options now.
Okay, so Councillor Antic has indicated that he's happy to move a motion to an amendment to that effect, so can we get the wording, please?
Yes, very, very good question, Chair, and I will now come up with it on the spot.
Point two could be with
options to be presented to the council meeting on next council meeting, 26th, to be presented to council meeting on the 26th.
Okay, so Councillor Antic, we've got Councillor Malani has seconded your amendment. Do you wish to speak to your amendment?
Well, look, just very briefly, I endorsed what Councillor Moran says about the disaster area that's been created down there and the need for some sort of remedial action before someone's injured. I mean, this is clearly not an ideal long-term solution, but we have created the problem, and I think it's incumbent upon us to put in some measures in place to remediate it as aptly and as cost-effectively as we can. So I support that.
Just deep down, I hope that the option presented might become something that's a good solution, because the lighter, quicker, cheaper separated bike lane that we roll out quickly is good, and I think that maybe this just might fast track the conversation.
Councillor Abbott.
Just quickly, look, I don't have a problem supporting this. I think safety is definitely paramount, but just wanted to ask a question. Previous to this, we did have a report presented to council around minor works to improve safety in the area. Where is that at? And secondly, is there any data or statistics that substantiate any current risks that need to be taken into account? I wouldn't believe council would do any project without trying to manage risk. So is there any data to substantiate any claim that there is risk for safety? I mean, it looks like there's a risk for safety, but is there a risk for safety?
Through the chair, I'll answer the first question first. The works that were agreed to at council, the $90,000, will be finished within, I think, 2 to 3 weeks. There's been a little delay in the greening through the intersections with our friends at Dipti. The second question in regards to, have we got any new data since the last report? No, we don't, but we're basing it on the 5 or 6 years of data, I think, that were outlined to you in that report from the independent review. So that's the basis of our decision.
So is it the administration's opinion that the crossover where the bike lane ends over that street, is there a safety issue?
I think, again, not entering into the debate, but we do have a Piri Street bikeway that's marked with bike lanes. So yes, it doesn't continue to North Terrace, but there is options for cyclists, including hook turns, to turn right onto Piri Street and left onto Piri Street. So that exists right now. So as I said, it's not a kind of a terminus of bike lane. It's certainly a terminus of the protected bike lane, but there is options for people to go left and right.
Look, I appreciate that, but I'm still not getting a direct answer. I think it's important that it's on record that there is a safety concern or there isn't a safety concern. Yeah. So I mean,
there's a safety concern.
There was a safety concern.
Yes.
Yes.
Councillor Corbell.
I wholeheartedly support this motion, and I think that it's a need that should be addressed and should have been addressed sooner. We have been waiting on this for various reasons, and I think that a temporary solution for the time being is really important, because the last thing we want to have happen is a serious accident, and there's plenty of near misses that occur, I'm sure, on a daily basis that may or may not be reported. And by 2017, we're going to have a new situation with the buses being diverted due to the Oban tunnel. So temporary solution, low cost, and I'm also in preference for the lower cost, cheaper segregated bikeways, which we can unveil throughout the city.
Mm-hmm. Lord Mayor.
Thanks, Chair. I support the aspiration of this, but not the timing of it, I must say. We will know, members, certainly by 30th of June, as to whether state government is going to be forthcoming in offering us a financial contribution towards a north, south and east, west cycling infrastructure in two directions across our city. And I don't want us members to be in a position whereby we have agreed to do this, although it has great merit. I certainly support what Councillor Moran is doing. My concern here, members, is with the timing of it. Is that we embark upon some what I would call remedial works, and then we find 7 weeks later, members, not long, the state government is making us an offer to co-fund or substantially fund, as the case may be. We don't know yet, but we certainly will know by June 2016 as a part of the 16-17 budget. So I would feel very comfortable if Councillor Moran was to recognise that in this motion, and if funding from the state government is not forthcoming, go your heart out. But if funding from the state government is forthcoming, I think we then could get the level and the quality of infrastructure which it's always deserved. And that's always been my argument. So I would put to Councillor Moran, if Councillor Moran is comfortable in just recognising in this motion that nothing be done until which time we get a determination of funding from the state government. I think that's fairly important because, members, we laid down cycling infrastructure in Sturt Street, we ripped it up. Are we going to lay down additional cycling infrastructure in Frome Street and then, let's say, with the advent of additional funding, then have a rethink and then do it differently again? I think that puts us in a difficult space. We've waited 18 months. All I'm asking, members, can we wait another 7 weeks? That's what I'm asking. 7 weeks, it's been 18 months. It's not an unreasonable request. I'll put that to you.
Councillor Moran, do you want to respond to that, and do you want to vary your motion?
Absolutely not.
Okay.
We have waited. That's enough response. We have waited 18 months.
Sorry, Councillor Moran.
Not
at the moment.
All right.
Just you've answered the question, so can we now?
Emphatically. Thanks for sharing.
It's a shame.
Practice. So I think we're up to Councillor Martin to speak to the amendment.
Yeah, sure. In the first instance, and I acknowledge the Lord Mayor's optimism that there will be an answer on this on the 30th of June. We were all expecting one on the 31st of March, and that didn't happen. And there's no guarantee there'll be any kind of answer from government on the 30th of June.
Well, there is a guarantee, because they have a budget.
I understand that, Lord Mayor, but ours will be cast in concrete by that time. It will be finished. Moreover, there is an assumption in the Lord Mayor's assertion that this may happen on the 30th of June, that this council will endorse the expenditure of $13 or $14 million for a bikeway on Frome Street. And
Councillor Martin, speaking to the amendment.
Yes, I am. It's relevant to the amendment, Chair. Frankly, that's dreaming that we're going to come up with $13 million for a Frome Street bikeway. This, however, is about protecting cyclists on Frome Street, and the administration's figures, which are there for us all to see at one and current until 2014, show that there have been 195 crashes up to that period over 5 years, 3% involving pedestrians and 15% involving bike riders. That is to say, five times as many bike riders have been injured on that stretch of Frome Street between North Terrace and Perry Street. The figures are compelling. It does require action. For me, however, and I would ask that the administration provide me with a briefing, the options which have been outlined require careful consideration because they involve the creation of part-time bike lanes and part-time parking. And each of those issues will be, provocative for each of the parties, that is to traders and to cyclists. So they need exploration and they need explanation. So I will support that, but I do ask for a separate briefing about which of those options would apply. And let me emphasize again, this, it is proposed, is a solution that will happen now to provide safety, to prevent deaths. The other proposal is just a possibility in the never never.
Councillor Moran, I've got you down next, but do you wish to speak to this amendment? Otherwise, I can put the amendment and we can get back to the substantive. So, does anybody else wish to speak to the amendment?
I'd like to speak to the amendment, I think, just in case it comes up. With options, we've been on.
You're happy with it?
I'm happy with this one.
Yeah, that's it.
So content to speak to that. So were you happy with the amendment? Well, yes. Not happy, but is everyone ready to vote on the amendment? Okay, can I put the amendment?
Through the chair, just want to clarify, there is no opportunity for a separate briefing on design options prior to the 26th of April. We're talking next week. So just to be clear on that.
Private briefing? Is that possible?
Okay. So can we put the amendment, please? All those in favour of the amendment? All those against? That brings us back to the substantive. Makes it the substantive, yes?
Just a very brief question. In reality, if this is budgeted for and the money's allocated, when will this be delivered? The Lord Mayor's talking 30th of June. I've never seen any of us deliver anything in like 2 weeks of reality. So if this is endorsed by council next week, when will it be delivered? The reality, by the time you go to tender and do the drawing.
July would be nice, Dan.
Through the chair, we will do it with internal resources, so we won't go out and use consultants. Yeah. So we're prepared to do that. In terms of timing, I'd really need to confer.
Can we get that by
perhaps we can get that information by the council?
We can do that. We can do that for next week. Okay, we'll include that in the.
All right. So. Going back, now we've got the substantive in front of us. Councillor, anybody else wish to speak to it? I'll go back to Councillor Moran to sum up.
Look, just in summing up and to answer the Lord Mayor's request, we have really been strung along waiting and waiting and waiting for our very optimistic Lord Mayor, who hasn't actually asked the council whether we want millions of dollars of co-funding. I, for one, don't. I don't want to the government to give, I do not want the government to give us $10 million and then we have to give $10 million. The street is a quiet, as a side street. It doesn't even go through to South Terrace. It is not a major street. We've stuffed up the bike lane and we didn't finish it. I totally agree with Natasha. I think whatever we do in this last bit is probably what will roll out for the rest of the city. Everybody here likes a dedicated bike lane, footpath, bike lanes, parking, if you can fit it in, road surface. That's what we begged after this crazy bike lane was first put in. Remove the tank traps, narrow by a few inches the bike lane, and you have a perfectly functioning street that could be rolled out for the rest of Adelaide. But that didn't happen because of the nature of the politics at the time. I suspect what we do from Pirie Street to North Terrace will be what we do over the rest of Adelaide, and we won't have to put it up. As for cost, it is only paint on the road. We regularly do kilometres a day filling in our white lines in the middle of the road. Just get the paint trucks down there. I'll get David Slammer to put up a shelf company, subcontracted. He'll have it done in a week. It is depressing that when the councillors say we cannot get, is it going to be July? It shouldn't be July. The day we vote for it next week, the guys should be out painting the lines on the road then. DIP team will fast track it. Everybody will fast track it because it is such a dangerous situation. The hesitation in saying it's a dangerous situation, say the bike paths can go left, all those bikes, and I've watched them day after day because my husband's rooms are right near the bike track, they all go straight into the traffic. They do not turn left and right. They go straight ahead to join the rest of the bike track
down past the medical school. So if anybody has any doubt how dangerous this is, I don't want to wait 7 weeks. I didn't want to wait 18 months. And I think we just get on with it. If we get some co-funding, which I don't want, and many councillors I've spoken to don't want either, I think leave the bike path as it is, do the things we ask the staff to do before, put the green through the intersection, take out some of the enormous cement things that the expert group suggested, which we still haven't done. Isn't safety a worry here? It was to the expert New Zealanders that came in. Leave the bike track as it is where it is, do the correct one to complete it, and let's take our bike infrastructure money and spend it where it's necessary. It is ridiculous. If the government, as a taxpayer, if the government came and said, I'm giving you $20 million to pave Frome Road with marble, I would say no, don't do it. Give us $20 million for something else that we really need. So I urge you to support this and have a good look at the options, and we'll decide which option on Tuesday.
Members, can I put the motion? All those in favour? All those against? That's Derek.
Division. No.
Call the division.
All those in favour? Councillor Milani, Councillor Antic, Councillor Abiyad, Councillor Clarahan, Councillor Martin, Councillor Wilkinson, Councillor Corbell, Councillor Sherwin, Councillor Murray.
Councillor Rowley.
Temple
Rowley.
No, but you said it might be the permanent. Okay, that brings us on. Does anyone have any other business? Members, any other business? No? Can we move on to item 17, which is a motion to exclude? Can I have someone move item 17? Moved by Councillor Clarahan, seconded by Councillor Corbell. All those in favour? That's carried. So members of the public, anyone who's not associated with this item of this agenda item, I ask you leave the chamber, please, and the doors be closed and the electronic. So that I can declare the meeting closed.
I'm running. She's trying to catch up.
Members, now the doors are open, I can declare the Economic and Community Development meeting closed and hand over to my colleague.
Guys, I'll just give you a couple of minute break to refresh. Still waiting on councillors. Let's go. I declare the business, the Finance and Business Services Committee meeting open on Tuesday, the 19th of April 2016 at 8 p.m. and would like to declare that the Finance and Business Services Committee acknowledges that we are meeting on the traditional country of the Kaurna people of the Adelaide Plains and pays respect to elders past and present. We recognise and respect their cultural heritage, beliefs and relationship with land, and we acknowledge their continuing importance to the Kaurna people living today. We have a leave of absence for Councillor Slaven, on apologies, leave on leave. Can I have someone please move the confirmation of minutes? Moved by Councillor Malani. Do I have a seconder for the confirmation of minutes? Councillor Moran, any debate? All those in favour? All those against? That is carried. We don't have a public forum and I will not be presenting a Chair's verbal report today. For items on block for consideration, I'm not going to move any items on block at this stage actually. I'm going to move straight away to item 7, the presentation from the Adelaide Central Market, quarterly capital works update, and I'd like to welcome Mr. Nick Bagakis and also Mr. Aaron Brumby. Apologies, gentlemen, for keeping you waiting outside.
We're bringing a thermos of great coffee next time.
Please do.
We'll be able to share it around.
So we take the presentation as read. You guys can go home. Please go ahead.
Thank you very much for allowing us the opportunity to present again tonight. This is an update on both the capital works, and I'll give you a little bit about what's going on at the central market. Our Easter results, as evidenced from trader feedback, is up 3 to 5% from last year, and Easter Saturday trading was the best ever in the last 10 years. We've made some changes to the car parking rates. These are meant to achieve greater turnover of vehicles and customers coming into shop. 75% of our shoppers come into the city by motor car. Is that okay? Now, the results so far this year is that the first hour is up 25%. 3 to 5 hours is down 17%. Car park numbers are up 5% overall this year over last year. Now the ACMA board will on Thursday be considering opening the car park 24/7 and providing low cost parking options. For example, this is after hours for the up to 500 employees in hospitality businesses in Gujar Street and nearby, which will then allow more on-street car parking for customers. We may also offer something similar to local residents who currently park on the street. Our community kitchen has been used 75 times since opening in August. An example is the celebration of International Women's Day, organised by the Migrant Resource Centre, which included Minister Bettison and the Lady Mayoress in the community kitchen. We're about halfway through the public consultation process to build an accessible toilet, as well as up to two parents' change rooms. I think it's 12 days, and we've had about 90 comments from the public. And finally, today we issued an open tender to retrofit LED lights in the Central Market car park, and this is our first step towards carbon neutrality for the Central Market. Happy to take questions before our General Manager presents progress on our capital works program.
Thank you, Nick. Any questions? If not,
you can catch me at the Central Market almost every day.
Excellent. Aaron, I look forward to your presentation.
Thank you. If we can just return back to slide one, that'd be fantastic. Thank you. So just a quick recap on what we had as targets for this year. There were 19 projects in total, 14 in the market complex and 5 in the market car park, with a total budget of $2.045 million, which is self-funded by ACMA itself, focusing on the areas of improved ambience, best practice retail, maintenance, risk mitigation, and sustainability. At this point, or sorry, I should say at the end of March, we had 37% of projects complete, 37% commenced, and 26% in the final phase. So in total, 74% actually underway and things changing with the market itself. Presently, we have no anticipated carryover of any of our projects to be completed this financial year, and are currently working on the projects for next year. Next slide. Three projects in particular, which we've had some great attraction on of late, relate to traders, where we've created some trader work groups on different projects. First one is the Isle Light replacement project. We've had two project meetings and the selections are ongoing. The dining area furniture replacement, we've had four project meetings and selections have been completed. And just finally, the access toilet and parents' room upgrade that Nick mentioned a moment ago. We've been and consulted with the Access and Inclusion Advisory Panel of Council. They gave us some wonderful feedback on what we were doing. They came out to the market, gave a number of great suggestions we've taken on board. We've now moved to public consultation and we've had 90 comments in the last 12 days. And we've still got 20 days left of the actual consultation to go. So, which is wonderful to see just how important the market is to the general public. I've got a photo of our public consultation that's going on for the accessible toilet and parents room. That, as I said, is traveling very well and getting some great feedback. One customer even wrote 2 pages of suggestions to us, so we're getting some wonderful feedback from
customers. Just before we get off that slide, where the yellow line is approximately where the accessible toilet will be constructed.
We, as I've mentioned in previous meetings, we track our Capital Works projects and I have a meeting with the operations manager weekly. We're currently on track with every project to deliver it within time and under budget. And that's all I have at this stage for an update. Any questions?
Excellent. Any questions, members? Can we go back one slide, please? Yes. Councillor Maloney, it's good. Excellent. Sorry, Councillor Bishop, go ahead.
One quick question. Just in terms of the car parking, because you've got the first 2 hours free,
first hour free.
So if you've got an increase there and an increase in your second, is how's that affecting your revenue stream from the car park?
We've been tracking revenue. In the first month of January, we saw a decline of around 10%. We anticipated something of that nature. Things have started to really smooth out at this point. For February, we only saw a 1% decline in revenue. And corresponding for February was a 13% increase in vehicles coming to the car park. What's wonderful is that it's actually created a higher frequency of turnover of bays, which is exactly what we want.
What we're trying to do here is change people's behaviours, and so we'll be running this trial for the entire year. People will that have come in for just the first hour free might crib over a bit and say to themselves, "Well, it's only $5. It's $2.50 now." It's about a third the price that you might pay if you're parking on the street.
That's interesting.
Excellent. Gentlemen, thank you very much for your presentation. And again, apologies for the wait.
That's fine. We'll see you next time or at the market sometime.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Members, before I go any further, I just wanted to thank Councillor Martin for acting as chair for the Finance and Business Services Committee while I was away for the last 2 weeks. Shame I missed it. I would love to be here. Moving on to item 8, For consideration recommendation to council, we have none. And items to committee to receive a note, there is also none. Out of session papers, item 10, if anyone like to remove any of those items? There's notification regarding the alteration of on-street parking controls and St. Andrews. First item.
Happy to move that if you want to move.
Happy to move. Can I get a seconder? Deputy Lord Mayor Hender. Councillor Clarahan, you had a question in relation to?
Item 10.
Yep, which one, one or two?
10-2.
10-2, St. Andrews Hospital.
St. Andrews Hospital redevelopment, if I got it right?
Yes.
Yep.
I just wondered what consideration has been given to the with these changes to the dog obedience school that happens, I think, on a Tuesday. And it's just been an ongoing nightmare over the last, I don't know, 20 years about providing ample spaces for those people that attend the dog training classes in that vicinity.
Through to the administration. Anyone can answer that?
Through the chair, we did take that into account when we allocated those car parks, and that though there isn't restricted parking or available parking for the hospital on weekends to
no, it's that. Tuesdays.
It's the day that the dog obedience schools occur is when that opportunity has been provided to them. There's no restriction on the parking during that time. All the other times the permit is available to the staff of the hospital.
Okay, so you've actually excluded the Tuesday from the permits.
And we've excluded some space to make sure that can occur as well.
Terrific, thank you very much.
Councillors, any other questions?
Oh, look, just briefly to that, I did look at the map and there's a large number of unrestricted spaces that have gone. Is it likely there are going to be residential or business complaints about that?
Through the chair, we don't anticipate that to be the case. We have engaged fairly significantly with the hospital and they've undertaken consultation also around the area to test that. So we don't anticipate that to be the case.
Any other questions, members? If not, as a mover or a seconder, I'd like to add anything with that. Can I put that? All those in favour? All those against? That item's carried. Members, do you have any other business? No? Okay, can I have someone move item for item 12, item 13, the options for the community land at 159 161 O'Connell Street, North Adelaide for exclusion? Moved by the Deputy Lord Mayor, seconded by Councillor Vershaw. Any debate? All those in favour? All those against, that is carried. And also, can I have someone move item 14, potential property purchase? Also moved by Deputy Lord Mayor, seconded by Councillor Clarahan. Any debate? I put that. All those in favour? All those against, that item is carried. Can I please ask any members of the staff or the public that are not directly related to any. Members, with that, I close the meeting at 8:27 p.m. Thank you.
I'll miss it twice because I moved tonight.